didn't realize.
I like Bonnie. Everyone they can likes hear you. Bonnie. Who's me?
Let me get
so
my
pattern. I should really be on my best behavior then.
Yes, no cheap shots.
I don't want the world to know what a clown I am. I mean, they think I'm a serious art model.
Here. Yeah, begin this.
What are you doing?
You just done that off?
Yeah, I want to tear it.
Perfect.
Oh, sorry.
Thank you. I know, I'm so gimpy. This is going to be interesting tonight. I hope I don't embarrass myself.
Well, it's not as bad as the time I fell off a scaffold, broke my wrist, dislocated my elbow. I felt like a total mutant.
A lot of times that stuff happens, too, at the most.
And it's so difficult to think of yourself as whole when you have all these gimpy parts.
I know.
It's so difficult.
I'm looking at it going, what is going on here? And not that, but just to get back in shape is going to take
We're doing the timer thing?
Yep. We're going to do 20, we'll do 25, if possible.
This.
And then, is that one working?
Yeah.
But let me see. Okay, the one that I want to pull
okay,
up.
Okay, here we are.
We don't
want to. The better one's over there that I can hear. But
can I pull up that image? I need to. I need. Can I?
Yeah.
Okay, so what I'm just going to do is minus this out for a second.
Okay.
How many do we have up?
This one will work.
Okay, I can get rid of this, I think.
25?
That's the one I need.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're on. Here's the one we're going for.
Okay, be careful where he's walking.
Yeah. Okay, so see the. Okay, you see that one? So what we got to do is we're going to
be very careful where he is standing right now.
So you're
okay. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. So your left arm's going to be on here.
Okay. So left foot behind.
Left foot here, right on your hip, and then I'll see if I can direct it. Exciting.
Okay, so we've got
seven people. Yeah, I told anybody. Probably Crystal.
Left behind the right.
Yeah, and then and yeah, okay, and then that knee will want to come. You'll want to sit. That knee will come this way. That knee.
This one?
Yeah, exactly. But not quite that. You can slip the. Let's see. What we can do. Here's more comfortable. Put this on your foot. That, so your foot bounces up in front of it. Yeah, your heel will be up here.
Oh,
so you don't have to hold your foot up. So let's see. I mean, it doesn't have to be exactly that. I just want to try to get. So you'll be looking out. You'll be looking out back.
No, that's me.
Thereabouts. Yeah. And then let me get the light.
Yeah.
Well,
I'm
lean back.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, I think I'm on.
It's looking pretty good. Let me see. Yeah, you're very close. Yeah, and then you can kind of, yeah, that's good. I think that's going to be good.
Is that where you want the hand?
Yeah, that's totally. I think, yeah, that's good, like that. That's good. That's awesome.
How's your life?
Am I live?
The internet land.
Do we want to start?
Where am I going to see the questions? Where am I going to see the...
I'm going to set that up.
Okay.
Okay. Do you want me to click
the time? Yeah. Okay. So can I go ahead and talk, Greg, or what do you...
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Well, welcome, you guys. Thanks for tuning in. It's kind of a trial. You're on back toward... Yeah, that's good. Chin down a little bit. Back towards me a little bit. That's cool. Yeah. And Greg, can I ask you to do one favor?
Mm-hmm.
If you can get over to the light, I just want to pull the light out towards me a little bit so I can get some light on the far side of the face. So tonight I'm going to be doing a 3 hour approximately, maybe 2.5 hour drawing because we have breaks that'll be in there too.
Like here?
Back towards me. Actually, not the top part, just because I want to get light on this far face. So the top's moving. Yeah, that's good. That'll work. That's totally cool. Okay, so we're good. So what I'm gonna do now is I got my pad here, and I need to find, we actually have a workshop going across from here. So this is our normal Friday night workshop, and I'm gonna be laying in a long figure. So what I normally do is I'll establish the bottom of the page, and I'll establish my top of my page here.
Yeah.
And then I've gotta try to locate where that figure is gonna fit within these parameters. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go out to the arm, I'm going to come back in from there. Now, unfortunately, you can't see the model I'm working from right now. So just, you know, I'll walk you through it. It's a seated male, and he's got a really great look. Big beard and really, really cool looking guy. So you'll see this starting to evolve here momentarily. Right now, what I got to do is I just got to make sure that I keep this. The pose really goes left to right. So what I might do at this stage, and this happens constantly, is I might move it over to the left a little bit. Because I need more room on my right of my drawing over here so I don't shoot off the page. But what we're doing is just trying to stay real relaxed at this point. And I'll talk a bit and I'll answer some questions in a little bit, but right now I'm just getting started. So I'm not going to be, you know, I'll talk and then I'll draw for a little bit. Just a little less talking than I normally do on my videos that you guys are used to. But, yeah, we'll walk through it. I'm going to start doing these on a bi-weekly basis, and I'll have some of the other teachers coming in to do them too. Some of the people that you're going to start becoming familiar with. These are guys that have been with me for a very long time. Some of them close to 20 years. And what we're doing here is let's just lay in. So we've got the foot really nicely positioned down here. That looks really good. We'll have the sweep of the tibia up into the patella area. And we're looking at the knee pretty straight on. Now the leg's going to go back here. And we have a negative space in between this other leg, so I might just put a little circle in there to represent that. I'm going to flow to the knee, and I'm just going to draw right through that form in a very relaxed manner. Now remember some of the stuff you guys are learning in some of these phases, if you are on the online program, I'm going to be showing you real time kind of how that works, so you can start to kind of you know, get more used to these principles of the abstraction, seeing the abstraction work in real time. The more content you can see, the more content I can deliver to you, the more comfortable you're going to become with these concepts, because they do take a lot of practice. It took me many, many years to get good at the abstraction, understanding and relaxing into it and letting it guide me through my drawings. And it's just like a GPS system for drawing, so it's really wonderful. It's the best system I've seen, personally. And there's other ones out there that are good as well, but this is my favorite. Okay, so the head, usually it's head, neck, shoulders, crotch, ground, and I work from the top to the bottom. But when I'm in this early stage and I'm just trying to get the big sculptural shape, sometimes you'll see me work a little bit in reverse and do more of the body and then kind of go back to the head and vice versa. So it's not set in concrete or stone. It's just an idea of a procedure that we want to start becoming somewhat familiar with, some kind of procedure. Now, right now, you can't really see me, but I'm working with a broken left arm, so shoulder. So this is the first time I've really been doing a long drawing since I did that, so this will be interesting. I think it'll be fine. I don't use my left arm for much, mostly holding my eraser until I switch it to my right in order to do some drawing with the actual eraser. But yeah, right now you just settle into a really relaxed pace. There's no rushing. You're not going to be laser accurate. You're never going to be that way. You're always going to be moving stuff around. So you want to stay light and non-committal. And just kind of have fun getting these light scaffolding lines in. And notice how I'm holding the pencil. Sometimes I'm up close. Sometimes I'm back. Okay. Drawing through the form. Okay, a little bit of the latissimus back here. And again, I've got it, you know, slunched a little bit more than I want, so I'm going to kind of have to start cutting in a little bit on my torso there. And the leg's a little low as well, so let's just start to move, or a little high, let's start bringing that down. And I want this rib cage cut in a little bit. Rib cage will open up. Okay, I'm going to bring that hand up a little bit, and the head might come up. I think I'm going to bring the head up a little bit. I have a lot of room at the top to work with, and I don't, you know, this is the time to make those changes, because if I don't do them now, I'm going to be putting, you know, back in my mind, it's going to be constantly thinking about, oh man, that should have been lower, that should have been higher. Better just to make the change. It takes a few seconds to do, and it always is a good call. I think it's good to watch people move their stuff around when they're drawing and know that it's not a perfect science and it's not something where you're going to be laser accurate. You never will be. You try to be as accurate as you can. You use everything from spatial relationships to, you know, to abstractions, to some Riley, to Loomis, to, you know, Hogarth, to, you know, all these different people that you cherry pick from. And you have to study each one of those individually. Okay, so this leg... You'll see me jump around a lot too. I kind of, you know, go up around the head, and then something will catch my attention down below. And the object is to bring the whole drawing up together, and not let it get too lopsided in any one area. The head will be my next plan of attack here momentarily. I'll go back to that head and really nail it. So, you know, you can see the leg looking at like a big cylinder. Got some nice drapery. We've got this drop cloth that is a little bit denser material, and it makes for really beautiful folds. Really great, great folds to lock onto. Okay, so I'm going to start integrating some of those folds into and around the figure to help lead the viewer ultimately around the drawing a little more efficiently. And so I'll actually redesign those folds and make them more conducive to what I want versus what... you know, what's actually happening. Sometimes I'll edit folds, sometimes I'll add folds, sometimes I'll change. So it's, again, good drawing to me is not literal at all. It's a process that is very creative, very dynamic. Part of what you see, part of what you know, part of what you wish you saw. And that last part of what you wish you saw, is really where the magic happens. It's where your own individual flair comes into the play. And when you're working accurately like we are with life drawing or representational drawing, you don't have a lot of room for self-expression, really. I mean, because it has to be accurate. Your edges have to be pretty accurate. Your values have to be on. Shapes have to be on. And if you deviate too much from that, it just really won't work as far as looking like what it was you were trying to draw. So we're kind of limited in some to some degree as to what we're capable of doing creatively. As long as we want to put ourselves in that category of a representational artist, something that represents what we see in a very accurate manner. So yeah, great model, one of my favorites, really fun to work from. So we're kind of just, I'm kind of just really dancing around the form right now. As I start getting my linear scaffolding in, I'll start to also do some mapping. And the mapping is where we delineate the shadows from the light and the dark and how it moves across the form and whether it's representing a piece of, you know, what kind of anatomy is it representing? Is it the pectoralis muscle, deltoid, bicep, what is it? We have to map this out. Okay, so I'm back up on the head and I'm gonna spend the rest of my time because I feel like it's occupying the space really nicely. And I'm glad I raised that head a little bit because it's gonna help me out a lot and I think it's gonna look a lot better. As I'm drawing, I put a stroke down and I stop and I lean back and I assess what's going on and then I move back into it. So I'm not drawing continuously. I'm constantly stopping and looking and reflecting and analyzing and cross-referencing. And so it's a very dynamic process. It's not a lazy process. It's a very engaging process. So if you're just phoning it in and drawing, if you're not feeling that way, like you're really thinking and really engaged, you're probably maybe a little too casual with the way you're approaching the situation. It doesn't mean you gotta be like really rigid, but you do have to be really present. And that sense of presence is just staying, staying in the process. Back towards me just a little bit, your head. Just back towards me there, yeah, that's cool, thank you. So I'm going in and I'm basically thinking about the skull, I'm thinking about the planes, I'm thinking about the muscle rhythms of the head, and I'm looking at the object in front of me, the model, and I'm assessing what, you know, where this placement of these objects are. And I'm not really worrying about the kind of calligraphy, meaning how my drawing strokes are going down or how cool they look or any of that stuff right now. That's way down the road here. So this is just, you guys see how it's starting to have a really nice feel. Again, I'm not worried about little individual hairs. I'm squinting down and looking at the big sculptural shape of the beard and the mustache as they interact with each other and cutting and carving it as if it was a large piece of clay. And I'm not sitting there and noodling around on little nuances of it. That comes later. So this is not the rendering phase. This is the lay-in phase. Now, it can look really nice, and it should, if possible, but it's just watch as it happens. Nice little rhythm from side to side on the eyebrow. I got to look at the distance relationship between the keystone shape of the eye, which is what John Vanderpoel calls it. It's a little keystone shape between the two eyes. And then he's got, you know, the planes of the nose, very distinct. So I want to, you know, start tuning into the character of his type. And I might play around with that character because he's such a cool looking type. I usually will take liberties and have some fun with it because why not? It's my, you know, it's my drawing, it's my interpretation. I don't have to be ridiculously literal. I'm not doing a portrait commission for somebody. So, you know, you might see me exaggerate or play around with the person's likeness. And I don't think there's anything wrong with that. Some people are very literal, and if you're one of those people, that's okay too. You're going to basically ultimately dictate how literal or how casual you are with this process. I'm not going to really be teaching you that. That's something for you to determine on your own. But for me, I love the great storytellers, the great exaggerators in the world of art, whether it's Frazetta or, you know, Edwin Austin Abbey or someone of that sort, you know, where they're really pushing the envelope with their knowledge base. And they're very accurate draftsmen, they're very accurate painters, but they also do a lot of invention and manipulation of the objects that they work from because they find that to be more to their liking. And again, you're going to have arguments on both sides. You're going to have people that are diehard purists and they're going to want to dictate, you know, spend 200 hours on a drawing and nail every little crease and crevice. And that's more power to them, you know, that's fine. There's nothing wrong with that. Each one of us has to choose, again, what we are after with our drawings and how we want to present them to the world. When you're doing live drawings, it really is kind of like going to the gym and lifting weights or working out. It's just, a process, and it's a process of becoming intuitive with certain things, really familiarizing yourself with body types and different different types, different situations, foreshortening. The amount of stuff you learn from a live model is amazing. Photo work is also extremely beneficial. There's nothing wrong with that. I think you should do both. You're going to do the majority of your professional work probably from a photo, I would imagine. I know I do. And I don't see any problem with that as long as you're continuing to work from life, get into life classes, continuing to train the eye, honestly. And then also then work from photographs, and it's not going to hurt you. And again, the spatial relationships and the difference between working from a photo and life is very minimal. It affects color more, and so it's more, in my opinion, beneficial to paint outdoors, like plein air painting, to learn color, because that's really where you know nature's best at doing that, teaching you that. But as far as, you know, the difference between drawing a model from a photo and drawing it from life, it's a little bit less, I think, of an issue. So a lot of you that are on the online are working primarily from photos because, again, you might be stuck somewhere where you really can't get into live classes that often, or maybe you don't have access to them. Don't worry about it so much. Down the road, you may find yourself moving somewhere, or you may find yourself starting some little thing up that you can get models and share with some friends and, you know, start a little workshop or something, or a little weekly workshop that you can get some practice. That would be great. Or going to a community college and use the model time and apply what you're learning with me or with us online, and then apply that in your classes, whether you're at a college, art college, or you're maybe at just a community college or something, taking some workshops or classes, weekly open workshops, whatever. So I've got my head laid in, and it feels really good to me. I mean, the distribution of weight around the pose feels really healthy. The distance relationships of the head relationship to the size of, say, the quad or the knee. I'm constantly looking at that head to help me make decisions. So it's the only thing on the body that's really not going to change with weight or with manipulation of some sort, like steroids or something. The body is going to alter itself greatly and can. The head doesn't really. So our head is always a great place to find some measuring area of the body that we can look at for the smaller, more superficial areas like the elbow or a knuckle or a length of a finger. Hard to judge that off of a knee or off of some other area that might be altering or changing in its size relationship due to different reasons. So yeah, really nice land. Thank God. No, it's always nerve-wracking when you're demoing and trying to talk a lot and then do something really decent at the same time. It's definitely a challenge. But one that I enjoy a lot. It really has always been very dear to my heart. I've done thousands of them, literally, and I still have not become close to burning out on the process of drawing the live model. I think it could be likened almost to maybe stage acting versus blue screen, or, you know, acting in a movie where you're actually, there is no, you know, you're faking maybe T-Rex coming at you or something, you got to act scared or something or whatever. But when you're in live action, kind of, you get the audience is interacting with you immediately. And if you mess up, man, you mess up in front of everybody. So it's a little more pressure. There's a little bit more. It's really kind of where the rubber meets the road, so to speak. It's the real deal. So when you're demoing and you're teaching like that, it's really exhilarating because you can't mess up, or you don't really want to. You know, you want to put your best foot forward always. And that gives you that little extra pressure sometimes to do that. So you can see I'm starting my mapping. I'm working my way systematically down the figure. I started with a big sculptural shape. Then I went back to the head. Then I fleshed out the head. And now I'm going down the body, and I'm putting another layer of information on. And that information layer is now mapping. And the mapping's occurring because there's nuances on the body that are turning away from the light source. Anything at a right angle to the light source is going to catch a highlight or is going to be illuminated. Anything that turns away from it is going to go into shadow or halftone. Depending on how extreme the object is that's turning away from the light source, we may get really dramatic lighting over that object. If the object protrudes greatly off the body, maybe a breast on a female or something, then you might get a really strong cast shadow. If there's a more subtle rolling form, like on a male, where the pectoralis does not protrude as much, then it's going to be a little bit more mellow. So the mapping will be a little different. So right now, I'm looking at all the little nuances, all the halftones that I run into as I'm navigating down the form. And my job is to contain them and make them into some articulate containment. Otherwise, if I just kind of, you know, doodle around and scratch around and hope something looks cool, you're in for, you know, kind of a rude awakening. It really doesn't work very well. We need to look. Scan, identify, predict, decide, execute, right? Scan the model, identify what's going on. It's the deltoid. Predict what it, you know, scan, identify, predict what's going to happen. What should I do? Decide, make a decision. You know, I'm going to use the side of the pencil and I'm going to go in and try to contain that soft area. But maybe I want to manipulate it a little bit because I know that there's multiple heads in that on the deltoid. There's a front head, a middle head, and a back head. From the positioning that I'm sitting at in this three-quarter pose, I'm really primarily seeing the front head and the middle head. The middle head is the most active anatomically of the three heads, meaning that it has some substriations within it. And as a result, you're going to get more play usually in that center area. It could be a little weird half tone that you're not sure what it is. But then you start thinking about it. So, oh, there's these fibers that kind of grip each other in that middle head. And you may be seeing one or two of those, depending on the person's physical makeup. If they're, you know, a competitive swimmer or a rock climber or something, maybe you're going to see, you know, quite a bit of that center head developed and ripped up a little bit. If someone's a little more passive and they don't do that much and a little more heavy set or where they have a little bit more fat pad there, you're not probably going to see anything going on in that area. But it doesn't mean it's not there. It just means it's not being seen in this particular situation. Now, your mom's got a really, this model's got a really great natural kind of build, and he's lanky and he's got good musculature, but he's not over the top. So it's really fun because you can really go in and it's a very ideal type. You know, it's really nice. So you can see our mapping there. It may look cryptic to some of you, but it really is quite logical once you understand what mapping is and how it operates. It actually has its own little language. And this is my interpretation of the lighting and shading that's occurring on the body before I actually fill it in. So in this circumstance, I'm actually really having fun kind of looking at what's up there and asking myself, do I want to be literal or do I want to manipulate this little piece of information? It helps if I know what that piece of information is. If I don't, then I'm almost don't have a lot of options. I'm going to really be stuck copying. And that's not really necessarily a bad thing. It's just better, I think, to be able to interpret versus not being able to interpret. You can always override your knowledge base. There's nothing saying you have to use it. But if you don't have it, you don't even have an option. So that's one reason why we train so hard. And a lot of people say, why do you train so hard in such obscure areas? Because I don't know when I'm going to need them. And when I do need them, man, there's nothing like having that ability to draw upon that knowledge base that you acquired at leisure during your student years or whatever. So, okay, I'm working my way down the forearm. So I did upper arm, deltoid, into bicep, brachialis, tricep. Now I'm into the ridge muscles, which connect between upper arm and lower arm, and that's the extensor carpi radialis longus, the brachial radialis, and then we get into the flexors and extensors of the lower arm. And we don't have any really supination or pronation happening with the ulna and the radius, which is one of the really crafty aspects of drawing this region is the fact that the two bones will flip-flop when they're moved into certain positions. And so if you're in a very mellow position where the bones are fairly parallel, it's not too difficult. When they start to kind of flip-flop and the arm does very complex motions, it can get a little crafty down there in that forearm. So just keep your wits about you. It's usually not too bad. Most people don't have them striated enough to where they really are going to be more than one or two of those flexors or extensors evident. So when you think of someone like George Bridgman, who's such a phenomenal anatomy instructor, he's primarily grouping muscles together into groupings, and he would call it the flexor group or the extensor group. He wouldn't so much delineate each one of them because it's very seldom that you would ever deal with every one of them in their full integrity. So sometimes it's better to think of them as a group rather than as individuals. Although it's nice ultimately to understand which ones are there and what their names are and where they insert and all that kind of good stuff. But you'll have plenty of time for that down the road. Right now, you're going to probably learn how to draw the figure really well way before you could recite any of the names or do that. And really, I think that's fine, unless you're going to teach it. And if you're a teacher out there that's wanting to teach anatomy, oh, I think that's that was
the other side.
That was the other side, you're on. That's okay. What's that? Yeah. It's all good. So it's looking really good. I'm really enjoying. I think we've got a few minutes left. Elbow back away from you a little bit. That one. Yeah, that's good. You're good. And so Yeah, right now, you know, again, you see some of the serratus muscles here. These are the sawtooth muscles that are slider muscles that are slipping out from under the scapula around the backside. The latissimus muscle is coming in front as well here. So we have a little play of form here. The pectoralis is coming down here. We have the external obliques, which intertwine between the serratus that are coming in, and they come down and become the love handles or the oblique muscle on the side here. So you can see my mapping of it is very discreet. It's going to be soft on top and hard underneath. So hard underneath, softer on top, harder underneath. And you'll see, depending on the person, maybe two or three of them. Not most of the time you won't see that, you know, tons of them. In certain people and in certain, you know, poses you might, but it's pretty hard to develop the obliques and the serratus. You have to be fairly lean and active to get those to actually be present. Yeah, so I'm mapping as I go. I'm just kind of cruising along here and just having fun, trying to look at shapes, and some of them I always want to try to ask myself, what is that shape, so I can then reflect on it. But yeah, it's looking really quite good. And we're only 20 minutes in, moving at a pretty good pace. Again, I would, when you guys are doing this stuff in your classes, don't, you know, just take your time. I mean, if you were to get something like this done in 3 hours, it would be wonderful. So you don't need to put pressure on yourself to try to finish drawings every, you know, get closure on every class you're in. It took me years and years and years to be able to make it to the top, to the bottom, and have most of my drawings be something I would want to keep. I threw out hundreds of drawings, maybe even thousands. I don't even know how many drawings have not, you know, made it. But each one of them was a little tiny piece of the puzzle that was working me towards proficiency of this sort. And you too will have to make that same journey. And it doesn't have to be a miserable journey. It should be a very fun one. So ultimately, as we get more knowledge to you, these exercises will become more and more enjoyable for you. Right now, they may be a little bit like pulling teeth. They may feel a little bit like, man, this is not that fun. So we're going to take a little break, and I'll be back momentarily to continue my process. Thanks for tuning in tonight. And again, we'll be doing this more and more, so hopefully you'll join me periodically to watch me do a painting or a drawing in this manner. What's that?
You're good.
Cool.
You're going to put this up.
Okay.
Just like to the right of it so they can still see some of the...
Can I just do it like that?
Yeah, but then people can't see the drawing. Oh. Actually, they can't see it. Let's see.
You know, if I get a little piece of tape or something, I can just tape it. Yeah. Or you can clip it.
See, we need about there, I think.
You know what I can do? Let's try this.
Okay. Oh, you know? Okay. There you go.
Okay. Is that okay? Lost
yeah.
A little bit of it, but...
That's awesome. Now, a couple things people can still hear us while we're talking. I'm going to move this
so I can see questions and stuff. Okay.
So you have 14 people watching.
Oh, cool.
And
do you want to try to get it over my shoulder a little bit more so it's coming right down a little bit more perpendicular, or
it's up to you?
I mean, how do you? I think it looks pretty good, but
yeah. What's looking like it's cutting off a little bit. Let me see if I can back up.
Broadcasting.
You got it.
Yeah, it's just a little. We're going to do a Friday broadcast. The people that are on the program can feel a little bit more the community of the environment. Yeah. Yeah, and just kind of, you know, it's just going to be on the drawing. So you're just seeing the drawing happen. You don't see the model, but you get to see the drawing start emerging. Okay. And it's going to be a really fun process.
So I came over a little bit of hair.
Okay, good.
Okay.
Yeah, what about the head cropping at the top?
That's right, so I just adjust this. This is 2 minutes delayed.
Oh, okay.
But the comments are real time.
And you're the one making the comments right now.
Well,
who's Mike?
Actually, one guy said, let's get it started.
Let's get it started.
and so you can take a look over there. You don't necessarily have to type anything back. You can just comment on it.
Okay, so those comments will just keep coming in and I got to scroll down with them? Or
maybe.
If they
you
keep
see
coming
it, I'm just adjusting it right now.
Okay.
So it's like 2 minutes delay.
Okay.
Okay. When you're done for today, if you wanted to, what? This one right next to it. If you click that, it'll stop streaming, and that'll close it off.
How did you get to that?
So it's the tab. Here's the tab that you're on.
Yep.
It's the tab to the left.
Okay. So it's the YouTube tab to the left. That. Clip so that and then
clip
stop
that. Stop streaming. Stop streaming. Close everything up. Just close everything up. Take it apart. Don't lose anything.
But I mean, what do you mean? Don't lose any of the apparatus?
Don't lose. Don't lose a cable.
Okay. So I'll get all the cables.
Yeah.
How do I turn this on? Just stop.
Just press that button to stop it for you.
Okay.
Okay. And then when you close it, turn it
off. Okay.
So.
Cool. Huh? That's going good, actually.
Yeah,
so far.
It's awesome.
Yeah.
So, and you got, you know, without us telling anybody, you have 12 people on.
Yeah.
So.
That's cool.
And if, Tom had put something up on Facebook.
Oh, yeah. So in the future, we'll just keep going.
Yeah. Now, next time, we'll do this, couple things. Well, I'll be around for the next one as well. One, we should talk about getting a microphone. The sound comes across okay.
Yeah.
But,
I have a mic in there.
It's probably too much to say. You can hear the music from the game.
Oh, yeah.
You have a long, flat mic.
Yeah. Well, we'll get it. Yeah. And if it's the best one, it's fine.
Yeah.
So when I go back, it's just going to be already still going.
So all I have to do is just move the little
If you were to edit it, you could edit it down and then
the word just goes out. I forgot to record it at the beginning. So I missed like the first 30 minutes. But it's just going to be good enough.
So, sounds great.
I'll take a look at it when I get home.
Okay. Yeah, if someone wants to watch it live, it's not part of the school. So they can still do that. It's just afterwards it'll be we'll all have archive. So we'll have and I'll have like they have their kind of and look is kinda and other shows they do the last yeah, they're doing it for the last year. So maybe we can get an audio also. I'll see you. Yeah, we'll just, you know, you can always set the timer at break time, too, if you want. Okay, you guys, we're getting back. Thanks for being patient. We usually take about a five-minute break, so you might want to, you can go take a little break yourself. And thanks again for, we didn't really announce this tonight. It's kind of a trial run, but we're going to start doing this on a bi-weekly basis, maybe even a weekly one. I'm not sure yet. We'll see how it goes. But also going to invite my other instructors to come in and draw, you know, off and on. So I'll be doing 1 week, and then you might see Eric or Lucas or Ben or even Meadow come in and do a drawing, and you guys can just enjoy watching the principles that you're learning online come into actual real life play. It should be really good for you. So I'm happy to be able to do that for you. Okay. So let's see. I think let's set it up. Maybe the body's a little bit more. No, other way. There you go. Yep. And then that arm looks now like it's kind of coming out. It was going out more of that. Yeah, there you go. So I think, and then, yeah, you're good. Let's see, the feet, we didn't tape you, so that's probably why. That leg looks pretty good. I think the knee towards me just a little bit. There you go. That should be fine. And then the head we'll work on now. So your body's good. Go that direction. And let's see, chin up a little bit. That's good. Good. Yep, that should be good. Okay. So now I'm going to continue on through the abdominal wall here, and I'm working I'm just working my way down the scaffolding that I created, which is my wireframe. And so let's see. The quad here is in a pretty foreshortened situation. It's pretty extreme. So, and it's going to change from session to session, right? There's no way to lock your model down, and that's why the site size method is a little bit rough when you're working from live models. I don't have any fundamental issue with it. It's just, it's more conducive to cast drawing and things of that sort. When you get into a model that's going to be fluctuating and changing, a grid system that's more rigid is very difficult to utilize because there's so many changes that are occurring. So what you really want to do, in my opinion, is acquire a great enough working knowledge of anatomy and a practical working knowledge of anatomy so that you can manipulate the object in front of you and not be manipulated by it. And that's a very big, different, distinction, you know. So what I have here is I have a knee that's in a slightly different position than it was, and that's fine. I'm not going to sit and spend, you know, tons of time trying to get it perfectly back where it was. What I'm going to do is rely more heavily on my knowledge of anatomy that I've acquired through academic training from books and other sources, and I'm going to use this scaffolding and refer to the model for lighting, because lighting didn't change that much. We maybe changed a little direction here, and you can't see that obviously, but I'm you know, seeing it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use anything at my disposal to get a good drawing. Cheat, change, alter, whatever it takes. And so for me, there are no excuses. Oh, the model moved. Oh, the lighting, something happened. Shouldn't be an excuse. If it's an excuse that, you know, the model moved, yes, it can be irritating, and yes, it's a little bit difficult, but it's trying to get you to learn how to, in some ways, learn how to work from invention, manipulation. Because in a lot of industries, you may work in the gaming industry, you might work in the entertainment industry of any sort, whether it's, again, animation, or it's you're working at Blizzard, Pixar, DreamWorks, Disney, Lucas. You're going to be making stuff up. And you're going to probably be manipulating reference that's not very good sometimes because you just didn't have time to get the right reference or, you know, whatever the case may be. And so, you know, this is where this stuff will really pay off in spades for you. Quick sketch training, invention manipulation training, figure invention. And again, like I said, we'll be doing, you know, lessons and phases on all these things down the road. We just haven't gotten those done yet, but we have them in planning. We have just tons and tons of content, and these are all things that we have to deal with on an everyday basis, because some of us work in the movie industry, some of us work freelance in gaming, some of us do, you know, fine art. It's all, I wouldn't say it's all the same, but it all requires, you know, virtuoso skill and manipulation of information, and it's hard to manipulate something that you don't know. So the key is to acquire a huge amount of information through diligent practice from live models and from photos, and systematically eliminating weaknesses through proper training until you have very little. Now that can take years, right? Because we're talking perspective, we're talking anatomy, we're talking figure, heads, portrait, still life, landscape, you name it. And each one of those is kind of a little subtle art in and of itself. And so what we need to do is prioritize our time properly so that we can, you know, allocate our time so that we can learn all these different skill sets. But they're overwhelming at times because there's so many of them. So if we just stop and train in anatomy all the time, then other areas are going to suffer greatly. So we need to kind of cyclically train in these areas and create a process of training that's consistent. And again, right now for some of you, this is a really awkward, difficult time because you're just getting your sea legs. You're just getting comfortable with the pencil, getting comfortable with these concepts. So take your time. You have so much to look forward to, so much wonderful, so many hours of great enriching learning and training, and try to look at it that way. Don't look at it, how fast can I get my training done? How fast can I become a professional? How about just enjoy drawing for drawing's sake? Learn to love the craft of drawing. Why? Because it's a link to painting. And painting is where you need to go, ultimately, in my opinion, because, you know, drawing is limited in its scope as far as what you can do professionally with it. But it's the link to good painting. But you have to think of drawing in the proper context, as a painter thinks of it. And that means drawing in tone, drawing in edge, and drawing in good value and control and all those things. Right now, it does look like a very linear process, because it is. I'm containing where my shading is going to go. I will sometimes spend a good portion of the class in this phase. And sometimes I don't even go past this phase. I just see how far I can take a lay-in. And how far can I use my scaffolding? How many abstractions can I create? How far can I get some of this skeletal information in as well. And I just play games with myself because, you know, I've been doing this for an awful long time and I just want to have fun too, just like you guys do. And so I'm pushing myself. I want to be better. I want to learn more. And you're always going to feel that way, I hope. You're never going to say, oh, I got it. I'm good at figure drawing. I think I'm done with that. I hope that never is the case. It has not become the case with me yet. And I hope it never does. So I'm just going to keep learning and layering information and, you know, just really enjoying doing this. Okay. So, yeah, the map's looking really strong. And very happy with the general feel. So what I'm doing now is just continuing through. The little fibula head here, which is the side. It's a subcutaneous bone. It's a small bump. You're not going to see it. Other than just, you have to know where it is. You got to know where to look for it. So the knee is a very complex area. And it's one that is just chock full of subcutaneous bone protrusions, tendons, ligaments, fat pads. And we have to look at all those little subtle halftones that don't really look like anything and somehow design them into an articulate explanation of that object, that knee. And so the patella is a sesamoid bone, and it's wedged in the middle of your tendon coming off of your quadricep, and it's attaching onto this little point right here. And what this point is your tibial tuberosity. It's the bump on the front of your shin right below your knee. And a lot of times you'll see that really developed large and distorted in someone that grew really quickly as a young kid, and they get, I think it's Auglitz slaughter or whatever, that fluid field, that area gets really agitated from growing, the bones growing so fast. And it, you know, again, I don't know all the technical mumbo jumbo about it, but anyway, anything that can get you to remember little bits and pieces of the body. The lateralis muscle, which is the outside quadricep muscle, lateralis, outside, medial, inside. Here's your medial muscle, lateral. And the medial aspect of the quadricep is lower than the lateral side. Now, don't worry too much about that. You won't see that. I mean, it's hard to see that this is behind this one in that perspective. But again, in a standing pose or a pose where you're going to see the leg more upright, you would be able to sense that and see that information. So yeah, look, I mean, already in this pose, we have an incredible feeling of three dimension. And we have no shading whatsoever, really, to speak of. We have some mapping. And we have the mappings telling us where the shading's going to go, and that's what its job is. But we don't really have any, but yet we still have this incredible feeling of depths and stuff. So we can get depths by overlapping lines and insertions correctly. And that's something to remember, is that you don't need value to make a great drawing. Okay. Jumping between indicating hands and fingers and drapery and drapery in the back. We got this drapery behind him that kind of sweeps. And I like to use that to kind of direct the eye into the center interest, which is his head, and then down the body. So it's nice if you have some drapery or some accoutrements around the model, paraphernalia, I don't know, all these funny terms for junk that's in the background. So that has a nice sweep to it, nice feel to it. We've got a lost edge here where when I squint, the shadow disappears into the dark background. So I don't necessarily need to finish that line. This tells me that it's a lost edge. And lost edge is your fourth edge. It's your mystery edge. It's the edge that really creates great, beautiful mystery in the drawing. If everything's spelled out for the viewer has a tendency to get a little bored, a little bit, like almost like you've dumbed it down too much for them. And they feel a little bit insulted. You want to make them participate in the drawing. Hook them with a good composition, with nice drawing, with good calligraphy, and then tell a subtle story about this particular model in this particular pose, in this particular situation. I mean, that's what I'm thinking of usually when I'm drawing. I'm not just drawing, oh yeah, I'm drawing along, everything's cool. I'm thinking, how can I tell this story? What would be the best light to draw this individual in? What can I accentuate? What can I leave out? What should I play down? What should I play up? So I'm dynamically approaching it at all times. Completely using 100% of my faculties, not daydreaming about what I'm going to do after class or what is going on in my life, but actually staying in completely 100% engaged, if possible, in the process. And it's one of the reasons why I think art is so addicting and so healthy. because it puts us in a state of presence that was our natural state, but most of the things we do in our lives take us out of that state and put us in a state of aggravation, it's not that kind of thing. So the things that we do in our lives that we most enjoy a lot of times are things that bring us into that state of presence. It could be a sport, an athletic endeavor that requires your constant concentration. It could be any number of things. And so, again, mapping this drapery is an art in and of itself. And since this is a figure drawing demonstration and a figure drawing, the drapery plays second fiddler. It's not the star, but it does need to be done well. If it's going to be done, it needs to be done well. Does it need to be rendered? No. Does it need to be indicated so that you can tell who's in front of who and what's going on? Yes. Do I have to take inventory of every fold? No. I don't have time to do that, nor do I have interest in doing that. So I'm going to edit out some folds. I'm going to play around with them. I'm going to design them. And that's where the anatomy folds come in. And we just finished a phase with Eric on the 7 key folds in drapery. So if you're having problems with drapery, visit that phase and watch it, because it's going to walk you through the different folds that you need to commit to memory so that you can start to design them rather than be perplexed by them and also maybe intimidated. And it's no different than designing the anatomy of a knee, really. And most drapery, you're going to find the you're going to find triangles everywhere. It's mostly lots of triangles all over the place. And so if you can just remember that the geometry of drapery, the most common geometric shape that you're going to deal with is a triangle. On the body, the most common one is going to be, most likely, an elongated ellipse. Torso, the pecs, the deltoids, the biceps, the legs, the quads, the calves, they're all just really eggs, you know, elongated ellipses. And so that's one of the most common geometric shapes that you deal with when you're drawing figures is an ellipse. Okay, my knuckle line on the finger here is going to run something like this. The thumb is placed next to the hip, so it's kind of passing behind the oblique. And so we'll get a nice block going there. Now we'll see how much hand we get done. We'll try to get as much as possible. Anyway, very nice lay-in so far, and I'm not just saying that. I mean, I'm just happy that it is, because man, it's always refreshing once you get past that awkward stage in the beginning of a drawing where you're trying to get it to occupy space correctly. You're trying to just get it to feel nice. So the other hand, I'm not going to make a federal case out of this hand. I'm going to try to keep it really simple. There's a thumb coming right at me, which is incredibly foreshortened. And the knuckle in here, the knuckle coming around as it passes back into some of the tendinous areas of the flexors, coming into the fingers, extensors, top. So yeah, that's got a nice feel. So I'm always trying to make it to these little areas of rest where I say, okay, good, that's in, and it feels decent for now, for where it should be. And the next thing is, okay, I got to take it further. So now that we've got it completely mapped in, I have not got my foot in, and I might as well map that. So let's just stay on target here. We're working our way systematically from the head to the neck to the shoulders to the crotch and to the ground. And as we bump into information, we deal with it. Now, sometimes you did see me jump from here all the way to the bottom and then back up. So that sequence is not supposed to be, again, something that's very rigid. But in general terms, it's smart to work from top to bottom. And that's really, you know, the general protocol that I've learned over the years. Now, the toes are always fun, and feet in general I find really fun, you know, fun to do. But they are very difficult. So are hands. So hands and feet are kind of the bane of a lot of artists' existence. They really get the caboose. They get kind of the hind quarter. A lot of people just don't study them because they're one of the last things you get to studying. And in the life drawing, you normally don't get that much time to do them. So they get kind of neglected quite a bit. That's where the good 15-hour life drawings come in, and the longer efforts where you can actually spend an hour or two fleshing out a foot. But again, this idea of, you know, doing 200-hour efforts all the time and things like that, I've never been a huge fan. I think that's a little much. I think every once in a while, yeah, maybe exploring a really, really long study figurative study to work on your high-end rendering skills or something. But it seems a little bit excessive to do such length on efforts. But I think if you're going to capture the soul of a pose and the soul of a sitter, it's going to be either done fairly quickly in the first couple hours, 2-3 hours, or it's probably not going to, you know, you're going to end up beating it up and making more of a kind of a constipated effort where it's maybe the drawing's a little bit uptight. And again, I've seen some incredible drawings that are just technical masterpieces of patience and perseverance, and they're not to take anything away from those. Again, you have to determine what level of finish is acceptable or is desirable for what it is you're doing. I work in so many industries, or have, where speed and efficiency is really the protocol. It needs to be good and fast, not ridiculously good and slow. Otherwise, it just doesn't work for the client. Now, in fine art, you can go a little bit different, and you can say, hey, I can spend copious amounts of time on an effort and get rewarded for it. And that's one area where if you are a really slow executor and you really want to be rewarded, then maybe fine art would be a better calling for you. But concepting, visual development, that's all about speed, invention, manipulation, idealization, and that's going to be a whole different skill set. It's a skill set that would be incredibly beneficial to a fine artist, but some fine artists don't see the value in maybe those skill sets and would not spend enough time to develop them because they're a little lengthier to develop. A lot more memorization, a lot more repetition. So let's see. So I'm coming around the calf. We've got the iliotibial band coming somewhere down the outside of the leg here and attaching onto that fibula area. And so a small straight can usually be found right in there. And that's that connector. Now underneath it is the laziness of the hamstring. The hamstrings, you know, the bicep femoris, the semitendinosus, membranosus. The bicep femoris, it's basically your hamstring group that's behind the leg. The top part is going to be your quadriceps, and those are going to be your lateralis, your medialis, your rectus femoris, stuff like that. So what I have to do is I have to make this articulate, and when I look up there, it's very fuzzy, it's very blurry, it's not that clear. I'm going to make it clear. How am I going to do that? I'm going to contain my shapes clearer. If I see a fuzzy shape, I'm going to make it into a specific shape. I'm going to think about what it is that that shape's representing. Is it a bone? Is it a tendon? Is it a ligament? Is it a fat pad? And then I'm going to do my best to design it in such a way that it tells the story of the knee the way I find it attractive. So a really nice feel right now. And I'm tempted to just write it out and take a picture of it in this stage before I go filling it in. So what I may do in order to do that, because I don't think I probably have more than another 5-10 minutes on this one, is I'm going to map in some of the drapery and take that up to a nice map as well. And then I'll start systematically filling it in. And by that time, see, the drawing's like 3/4 of the way done right now. This is the hardest part of a drawing, is the lay-in, because that's where all your thought process is really in full activity. Filling it in is kind of busy work. It's not as hard once the map has been done. It'd be almost like equivalent to an inker inking a penciler's work. So the penciler is the one doing most of the heavy lifting. And then the inker's coming in and going over that pencil and making it, you know, bringing it to fruition. They also have a hard job, so I don't want to dumb that down because inking is incredibly difficult. But back in the day in comics, you know, it's not done that much anymore. Everything's gone digital and this and that, which is not bad. It's just different. I still like the halcyon days of inking when you have, you know, guys like Neil Adams, you know, and the teams of guys that did these incredible comics, you know, and then guys like Frazetta that could do actually the penciling and the inking at a virtuoso level, which is a little more rare. Bernie Wrightson and you know, just these canons of comic inking, as well as, you know, Gibson and Charles Dana Gibson and Joseph Clement Cole and Franklin Booth and Montgomery Flagg. I mean, these are the fantastic inkers of the past when inking was kind of the medium of choice before color came in, before color printing came in. These guys were rock stars during their time. I mean, it was amazing. Okay. So continuing to, you know, get the drapery in, just looking at, do I want to add the little chair in the back? Do I want to put a little block down here with the timer on it? What do I want to do, you know? How much do I want to put in there? Well, this is the medial malleolus, or this is the inside ankle bone, and it's basically part of the tibia. Fibula is on the outside. So we have the lateral malleolus and the medial malleolus. lateral outside, medial inside, and they're attaching to the bones. Like the fibula in this bone are connected, and it runs parallel to the shin bone, which is your tibia, and it's connected. So they run right next to each other. High on the outside, low on the inside. So this bone's higher on the outside, and it's lower on the inside on the tibia. Something you can often get confused with and get them backwards. It's not a deal breaker, but it does look a little awkward, and people kind of wonder what's going on, why it's looking kind of weird. Okay. So again, I'm trying to take this map, well, for a couple reasons, as far as I can, because I want to take a picture of it before I fill it in, but also just to show you that the mapping phase is incredibly efficient at producing three-dimensional drawings. And now, this is just ready for the tone to just be easily put in. And then once the tone's in, what I'll do is I'll assess whether or not it's ready to go to full black, full value. Full value, basically, you can't turn around from. You're not going to be able to go back from that once you ingrain that into the surface of your of this newsprint, because the newsprint's not very durable surface and it won't take huge amounts of abuse. We like that because we want to promote discipline. And we're not disciplined if we can just run amok and go crazy and mess stuff up and not have any ramifications for our actions. That's another reason why digital is so lenient. You don't really have to be responsible for messing up a digital painting. You can always undo what you just did. You can always go back and undo that. And that's not to belittle that medium, but it does not require the same amount of concentration and tactile sensitivity and discipline that a surface that will get abused and will get ruined will take, you know? So we're always trying to figure, you know, and if you guys want to ask questions, feel free. You can type a question in and I'll glance over at the computer, and if I see one come in, I'll answer it for you. If there is someone out there that, you know, has a specific question about what I'm doing, or why did I just do that, or what am I thinking about? Okay, Ram, so head back towards me a little bit. Not like this tilt. Yeah, and then back that way. So yeah, good. So it'll be left to right as well as tilt this way. So I'll tell you, it's a tilt issue or it's a left to right issue, but you're doing great. Fantastic. Okay, so so again, it must be odd for you guys to watch the character evolve without having seen the character, but really quite a neat drawing happening here. So very thankful for that. Let's see. What more can I do here? So yeah, you guys will probably hear a little bit of ruckus in the background and stuff, and there's people meandering around because we have we have two models going. We have one over on the other side of the room, which is the normal Friday night workshop. And I was actually originally going to do it over there, but I thought it would be a little too disruptive to be talking so much, as well as having to set the camera up and take up a couple spots because it's usually pretty crowded over there. So I just decided to do it on the other side, the painting side. So I just set up a model over here, which works really good. Sartorius muscle goes from here down to the knee here. Down in this little area here is the pes anserin tendon, which is actually a group of tendons from the quadrant part of the inside muscles, as well as the groin muscles, as well as the hamstring muscles that attach on the inside of the knee, create a little bulbous area there when the knee is kind of scrunched up. This area right here where I put the X is actually a subcutaneous part of your femur, the upper leg bone. So we have a lot of bones that are able to be palpitated or touched or felt in the knee. And so it's a very active area, and it has to be because it carries the full weight of the whole body. So I'm going to go ahead and take a little break like I did before. You know, it's about a 5-minute break, so take a break yourself, and I'll be back in a minute to continue to fill this in and bring it up to a finish for you. What's that? We're looking good. Looking really good. Put that on there.
Have you seen that? No.
What's that?
Yes. No.
Oh, it's just from my my iCloud thing. Is kind of.
Oh. It's Atelier TV.
It is. I know. It's funny.
Oh. They weren't doing this when you were a kid.
Nah, man, that would have been so cool.
I know. Can you believe that?
I know. It's been a lot of cool, you know, really neat things that have come with technology. Some really bad ones as well, but that's always the case.
Heck, you might not be old enough to remember, but there used to be something called a typewriter?
Yeah, I learned how to type on the old school typewriter.
You did?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know you were that old.
Seventh grade. I'm 44.
But I'm telling you, you can't get rid of a typewriter.
You can't get rid of one?
You can't. Nobody wants your typewriter. They even had them electrified. Nobody wants them anymore. It's so
for science
I'd like to put some of those people on a leash, see how they like being yanked.
I hear you. I hear you.
Man, it's just, I walked up this one gal who was trying to train a German Shepherd, the animal was being abused. I said, you know what? That's animal cruelty.
She
looked at me like, who do you think you are?
Okay, we're gonna get back going here. Let's see. So everybody, thanks for being patient. I'm getting back ready to get back into this drawing. So let's see. We're gonna fill it in now. So I'm gonna be doing mostly fill in. That's not the most exciting thing to watch, but it's not. You know, I'll do some rendering as I go too. So you might find it interesting. The main thing right now, what you can do is you can rip off a piece of paper off your pad, somewhere lower in your pad. And just have a page that you use as your rip-off page where you rip it off to balance your hand on. And this is going to be so I don't smear my drawing, all the delicate stuff that I just did. So you just pull off a little scrap piece. Now this is going to be hard for me. Actually, I don't know if I'll be able to do this because I don't have the use of my left arm. But I'll just do it the way, you know, you can do it without it, but it can smear. The nice thing about the charcoal, and this is what I love about this, is you really, it's not vine charcoal. So you can put quite a bit of pressure on it, and it's not going to erase. Like, vine charcoal, my drawing would be gone with what I just did. So, okay, let's see. I'm going to get my model back, position. So, Neil, there you go. Perfect, perfect, good. Head back, that's perfect. Yeah, very nice. Okay, so we're right back in it. And now, I'm going to go back up to that head. And the nice thing about layering your next layer on top and starting with the head is that your hand's not going to get over all that tone as you work your way down. So it's also, it's not only is it logical, but it serves a very practical purpose as well. So let's go in to this eye. And what I'm going to do is, the eye is completely in shadow on the model in front of me. And that's what this map is representing. So what I'm going to do is go in and start filling it in. Now I'm holding the pencil a little differently, you notice. More like I write. Now, I made my initial lay-in pretty dark so that I'll be able to see it when I go over it with a glaze of tone. Now, this is not the actual tone that I see in front of me. It's a placeholder. So I want it to be somewhere in the value number 5, which is the middle of the value scale, right? 10 being, it depends on how you want to look at it. Some people look at 10 being white and 0 being black, and other people have it reversed, depending on how you learned it. I always think of 0 as black and 10 as white. So that's how I've always thought of it. If you think of it the other way, it doesn't matter. It's just semantics. So let's fill in the shadow. Let's go into the mustache and let's fill in a little bit of the shadow there. Now again, the map that I originally did makes quick work of this because it already tells me where my shadows go. I just have to be diligent and careful when I fill it in. So I'm going in and I'm filling in areas of the beard. Now there's hairs and there's little active areas, but I'm not going to get involved in that yet. That's the filigree, that's the window dressing, the little stuff that you put on the very top. Right now we're about just trying to get our map filled in. So I'm holding the pencil back pretty far, as you can see, and I'm just kind of filling it in. Now I could go on the side and do it. It depends. Sometimes I like a little bit of activity in my shadows, just to make it look cool. And it's not really something you're going to see up there. It's just something that I think looks good calligraphically. So we have to ask ourselves, some things we do because we need to represent the edge properly. Other things we do because we want to just have fun and play around and make it look cool, make it look nice. At the end of the day, the drawing should look attractive. Now that doesn't mean like a pinup or pretty or this or that. It just means that the shape should be well articulated. They should represent what they're supposed to. They should be very well thought out. Now, learning to design a good shape is an art in and of itself, and it's not something that's very easy to pinpoint. I'm always talking about this in my classes, you know, good design. How does one know what a good design is? We usually know it when we see it, but it's not always easy to create on our own. And it would be nice if there was some formula, but it would maybe bore the process, it would make the process a little bit more boring. It's more exciting not knowing and having to kind of find it and explore it, I think. And so, you know, you just got to think about all these concepts in general terms. I mean, a lot of them are not meant to be set in stone. They're not meant to be so rigid. And a lot of people want to make them rigid because they want particulars. They want specifics. Those are the people that usually, you know, are more geared towards, you know, more academic pursuits. Maybe they're more scientifically inclined. Maybe they're more accountants. There are people that, you know, need to play by the rules in their industries. They need to have strict rules, engineers, stuff like that. You know, I don't want to make drawing into engineering. I want to make it a dynamic process. Yes, I want to understand the process and I want to respect it, but I want to also enjoy experimenting with it, playing around with it. So here I'm going into this head, and I'm going to take this head up quite a ways. And so I'm actually working, not only am I injecting my shadow pattern, but I'm also manipulating my half tones. So this is a little out of the range of the very, very rigid way that this process a lot of times works, is you don't really get into this halftone manipulation quite so early. But I may not make it back up to that head, depending on how fast I move and what happens. So I'm going to do is, you know, get that head looking pretty nice, and then I'll move on. And when I come back to it, it'll be very easy to just put the last finishing touches on it. Yeah, thanks for the heads up on putting that barrier up with the kneaded eraser. That would work. It's actually working pretty good the way it is, and I appreciate your you coming up with that. That's pretty cool. But yeah, it's really funny because it's with me, you know, I'm not a very I'm an aggressive painter. I mean, I paint very guttural, you know, but in drawing I paint more finessed. I'm a little bit more, my process is a little bit more controlled. I don't know if that's what the reasoning really behind that is. It just seems to be the way I draw versus the way I paint. Drawing to me seems a little bit more, you know, strict in some ways. Accurate drawing. Painting, you know, I use my fingers. I'll scrape with palette knives. I'm looking for an effect, and I'll do whatever it takes to get that effect. So, you know, my approach in painting is a little more aggressive. So the head's starting to come in, and you can already see how it really has a good read, but it's minus the full value range. It doesn't have the full blacks in it, but we want to work our way up to those blacks. Yes, I see blacks up there, but I need to be strict with myself and refrain from going in and doing that too early. Now, my eraser could be used to pull back out some of the hairs. It can be used as a sculpting tool. It can be used as, think of it as your white paint. Don't think of it as your eraser. Like, oh, I'm going to use my eraser to correct mistakes that I make. Yes, you could do that, and you will need to. But you can also use it with an idea behind it that it's actually more of a sculpting tool. And you want to form it, and that's why those kneaded erasers are so nice, because you can kind of sculpt them into small, almost like brushes. You can literally almost use it just like a brush. Okay. Okay, got a really nice little head going here. My pencil's okay. I haven't tuned it up in a while. Usually you want to tune it up in between each break. I sharpen up about 3 or 4 pencils just in case I break them, because you will. Doesn't matter how good you are, you're still going to break pencils. Sometimes they just have little hairline fractures in them and they just break on their own. Sometimes they fall off the, you know, table and end up on the ground and crack off, and you don't want to have to stop your model time and run back and be disrupting the class and all that stuff. You want to kind of try to, I usually have two to three of them sharpened up. I usually have 2 behind my ears and then 1 that I'm using. That way if one breaks, I just set it down. I don't miss a beat, and then I grab the other one and I move on my way. Okay, so there's a double shadow underneath the beard. There's a deeper shadow that I'm filling in right now, and then there's a general shadow that's not quite as dark. Now, at this stage, I'm not going to differentiate too much between them. I'm not going to try to do it completely accurately, but I will show a little bit of darker aspect to this shadow. I might use my finger a little bit to soften. Okay, just filling in. And again, the drawing is starting to take shape. Okay, this is your upper pectoralis, one of the pec muscles. It's got three heads. One of them is pretty deep, you're not gonna see it, but you basically, this area, again, you'll see some striations. It attaches into and onto the bone underneath the arm there, onto the humerus. We've got a really nice crease line between deltoid and pectoralis that he's got going here. And then you've got a very substantial vein that's coming down the bicep, which is one of the most common vein networks. I don't normally study very intensely because they vary on individuals so much. It's one area that, you know, I'm kind of reluctant to dive into and study really incredibly academically because I just don't really see the major need to do that. Except, you know, again, as I layer over the years more and more into more advanced areas of drawing, you'll see me, you know, start to layer even more. So I might go into that vein networks later or something, you know, because again, right now, like the areas that are still a little bit wanting on my own anatomical training is probably feet and hands. I can draw them extremely well as far as reciting that all the actual academic names of them and stuff. I have not yet pursued that, but there's so much to learn. You just have to bite it off in little chunks and study it over a long, long period of time. And that's the best way to go that I know. So I'm filling in my shadow pattern. I am dealing with some half tones occasionally if they're substantial enough and I feel like I want to deal with them at that time. Otherwise, I'll come back in and do another pass later. Okay, smooth that a little bit. Okay, getting in here, start maybe putting in some of the shadow too. So every once in a while, you might want to take a break from your figure and start just blowing in some of the tone in the background. Start getting some of the drapery filled in, just to take a rest. You can do a break time too, I mean, but sometimes you just need a little break from the figure when you're working on it because, you know, again, you're trying to bring this up as a story. And part of the story is the drapery. The drapery is a supporting actor, just like a supporting actor in a movie. You don't want it to trump the main actor, but it still needs to be dealt with in a very judicious manner and also a respectful manner. So anything that's going to go on this page that's going to either accentuate the model, accompany the model, needs to be done very carefully and very professionally. You know? Okay. So drapery is harder underneath and it has a little soft core shadow on top. And again, I don't want to get too dark with that, but I want to make sure that it differentiates itself because in a minute I'm going to put a general tone over the whole drapery because the drapery is dark. I'm just reading one of you guys' questions. Do you ever find mapping out shadows to be a daunting task, especially if the surface creates a lot of small shadows? Or is it simple because of your experience? It's a little of both. You know, I mean, mapping is an art. It's the art of containing and basically making a three-dimensional object on a flat surface. We have to use, you know, without lighting, if we were to use very ambiguous lighting, flat lighting, we would have a very difficult time getting the body to protrude. Now, guys like Bouguereau were the masters of subtle lighting and would use it because it's more challenging and fun for them. You know, as you get to be incredibly advanced with your knowledge of anatomy, navigating halftones could be exactly what the doctor ordered. But, you know, as far as when you're first starting, you want those really strong light and dark shadow patterns so that it's not so hard to map, not so hard to see the mapping. So that's a very good question. But yeah, I find it still challenging, you know, I think it always is, you know, but the more you know about anatomy, the easier it becomes, that's for sure. Anatomy is kind of the linchpin to good, you know, masterful drawing in general, whether it's anatomy as it's thought of in landscape, you know, the anatomy of rocks and trees and different kinds of trees and stuff like that, or in the human figure where it's the anatomy of the actual musculature, the bones. Okay, so I'm going in and again, just very subtle on this half tones. So right now I've got them a little punchy. So you might see me glazing back with my finger or something as I work down the form. Let's see, let's go over in here. And now see, these are lighter half tones. And so I am filling in my shadow patterns, but also I'm filling in some of my lighter half tones at the same time. Later, when I bring it up to a full value finish. Okay, Rob, so I think the arm, this hand here, it was more like crunched in there and a little bit more angled up. So I think you might've been sitting up. Yeah, or let the elbow down a little bit. That's okay, cool. So you might've been sitting more upright a little bit or something. Yeah, I think that, yeah, that's it. Okay, and then rather than having the hand going like this, kind of put that finger, yeah, let it set in there and let that thumb come up around your love handles up there, you know, like your elbow. So now relax it. There you go, perfect. Thank you. Okay, so again, still just filling in my shadow pattern. Okay, a little bit of drapery here that bleeds into the side of the torso. I may want to differentiate or, you know, get that to pop a little bit more by going back in and outlining a little bit of the torso so that it doesn't just get completely lost in the shuffle there. Okay. Now my core shadow, which is a shadow that exists between the light and the dark, I want to use that to, again, create more punch and pop out of the drawing, but also to differentiate the shadow from the light even more. So a lot of people, you know, I really manipulate my cores a lot. I like to do that. Some people don't. It's really up to the individual whether they, how far they want to manipulate those core shadows. But I like the look of strong core shadows. So I do utilize them a lot. Just kind of containing the cast shadow a little bit off of the pectoralis muscle. It's probably not quite as substantial as what I have, but it still looks fine. Okay. Indication nipple there. So upper body is getting pretty well established. Okay, let's. Okay, let's continue shading this torso section. And so I'm going to go in and just, these are light halftones. So these are halftones when I squint that are relegated to the light. So these halftones in here should be so subtle that when you squint, they more or less disappear into the light area. Within, you know, so that's what I kind of see up there. Now, if I get them too dark, they're going to start looking like they want to be shadows. They're either going to accentuate the form and make it look a lot more ripped up, or, you know, because they're going to become more substantial, which means the only way they would do that is if they were more deep or more, you know, again, more substantial. So that's the kind of subtlety that I'm looking for, just a really subtle halftone representing some of the abdominal wall, epigastrial section. So now I'm swirling around and I'm kind of coming in on the tip. And I'm going to go back in, get that navel in. And there's a little separation here between the oblique and the abdominal wall. Trying to keep it real subtle. So you might see me put a tone in and then just kind of knock it back down again with my finger a little bit. Just using it very discreetly. The oblique, I might slip a little tone over it. Okay, the cast shadow of the hand onto the quad, I'll go ahead and put that in. I should probably deal with that hand a little bit, even though I'm not sure I'm gonna try to get a nice indication of it. I don't know how much I'll get to ultimately do with it, but. Okay, so the forearm has quite a bit of complexion, so I'm gonna just kind of creep up it with a little bit of tone here and put a little bit, a glaze of tone over the whole thing. That's why I went a little bit darker with some of these half tones here, shadow mapping, because, you know, I'm already thinking ahead that, okay, later I'm gonna put a tone over that, and if I do them too light, they're just gonna disappear. So they look a lot, it looks a lot better now that I put that glaze over it. Before it was a little too punchy. It is still a little too punchy up in this upper arm area, so I might wanna do the same thing, is just put a nice little glaze. Be careful when you do this. You don't want to make him look like he's dark complexion. You just want to make it look like there's a nice little play over there. Now, this major vein that runs down the bicep, we're going to just kind of inch our way along it. Pick it out with an eraser. It might get a little cheesy looking. So you want, you know, veins are hard. You know, a lot of times they can look like spaghetti, just, you know, kind of strung onto the person if you don't watch out. Okay, so I'm going to go around the outline. Now, I don't want to outline his body equally everywhere. So I'm going to skip, and then I'm going to pick up again, then I'm going to skip, and then I'm going to pick up again, just randomly so that I can get that body to pop, but also to get a line weight variation around the exterior of the form. That's something you don't hear a lot of people talk about. It's very important to an attractive drawing. Harold Speed's one of the few guys I see that really talk or have read and have him talk about that. You don't read a lot about it a lot. And so it's odd because it is very strong effect to get around the figure is variation of line weight. Okay, so filling it in, I'm going to move the board up a little bit on my knee so I can get down to the lower area of it a little bit better. So now I'll start mapping in some of this. Now I don't want my mapping that was originally there to disappear, so I might have to, again, kind of go in and reaffirm some of it before I put that glaze of tone over it. Otherwise, it might just disappear into that tone. So sometimes you got to do that. You got to go back in. Okay. So I'm going to go in with this quad, and I'm just going to start laying in a tone over it, a little tone. And I'm kind of up on the side of the pencil, on the tip a little bit. Now the drapery, I'm squint down and I'm just gonna start laying in some of my big sculptural areas of it, where the shadows are in it. I'll pick out with eraser and do all kinds of, you know, stuff here in a minute, but. Okay, let's get this patella area working. Again, now if you were to see the model, you would recognize that, again, the patella in the area here is just almost a convoluted mishmash of little tiny halftones that don't really have a lot of articulation visually. It's my job to make them conform and become more articulate. How am I going to do that? Through design, invention, manipulation, idealization. A lot of concepts that a lot of people don't talk about that much. Why? Because they're very cryptic, very difficult to learn, not easy to teach, not easy to do. So the best way I know to learn that is to be around good people, watch good people, and absorb it through their efforts. And again, that's one of those things you guys have access to online, is you can sit and watch this thing, you know, watch this stuff over and over again and really, really absorb it that way. And that's a luxury, because even in our classes here at the Atelier, you can't really film. So you have to see demos over, you tons of demos to get the same absorption that some of you are going to be able to get a lot quicker. So I think that's a real plus for the online people. Again, extrapolate what you're watching me do and go into one of your own classes or go into the school that you're taking classes at or the college or whatever and try to apply some of this information. It might not, at first it's not going to be like totally clear and it's going to be a little bit convoluted and it's going to take a while before it sinks in, but you can go home and do another study and tune in on Fridays and watch us do this kind of stuff. And over time, you're going to start being able to do it. It's all going in there. It's just you got to learn how to retain it and then bring it back out. And that's the hard part. Visual memory takes time to build, just like a visual, like a body muscle on your body. It takes a lot of work to develop big pecs or well-defined body. And it takes a long time to develop a visual memory to be able to retain this information. And that's one thing they just never tell you in school. They never tell you that you have to memorize ridiculous amounts of stuff. It's all about, you know, I think it's because most people would be scared away by that idea. But it gets easier over time. And you may not have, I don't have a visual memory. I mean a photographic memory. I have a strong visual memory put in place by hard work. And that's why, you know, retaining a lot is because I've practiced a lot. And that's why I continue to practice, because I want to maintain and keep that muscle in shape. If I was to stop training, the muscle starts to atrophy, just like a muscle on your body. And over time, it gets really weak, and then you got to build it up again. And it's hard to build them up, and it takes a lot of time and energy and focus. So, you know, you don't want to have to keep going through that. Once you got it up, keep it up. That's the old saying. It's not that hard to maintain. It's hard to get it back. A little bit of maintenance, keep your skill sets up. I'm very watchful and very careful about that, you know, because I know I've been there before where I've taken, I took a, once when I was younger, I took a year off And when I just got out of school, because I was pretty fried and burnt out from all the, you know, 15, 16 classes a week or whatever I was doing. And I just wanted a little break. So I didn't really do much for about a year, 9 months. And I came back from that period and then thought I would just, you know, roll back in and be doing great drawings like I used to and everything was going to be cool. It took me about a year or more to get back to where I was when I took off that 9 months, at least a year. And I, from that point on, I never really wanted to take a really ridiculous amount of time off anymore because it was just too painful to get back to where I was. And it was just, oh, it's terrible. So I guess the moral of the story is continuity and consistency over time is what you want. And you're never so good that you were, you know, you can always say, oh, I studied anatomy 10 years ago. Well, that means nothing unless you've studied it every day since then. It's probably completely hidden and gone. It may come back a little quicker, but it's still going to be a lot of work to get it back to where it was when you took it back whenever you were thinking about, you know. Okay, so we're filling this in. And again, most of the time, I'll try to keep this really inspirational. I don't mean to be, you know, getting you all bummed out or anything. You know, just trying to point out things that I've noticed that might be helpful to you going forward. Okay, coming down the calf. Okay, my timer just went. So the model's taking a break. It's going to be another 5. Again, if you have some questions you want to fire over, fire them over. Otherwise, we'll take a little break, and I'll come back and continue to fill in the legs. And then I'm going to get ready to start putting in my final flow through the drawing to bring it up to a finish. So we're about 3/4 in right now, or half to a little bit over half, heading towards 3/4. And we're already almost, you know, we've got about another hour or so. So thanks for joining. I'll be back here momentarily. Take a little break, and we'll see you in a little bit. I know, it's supposed to rain. Which is, we haven't had enough of that, so it's good.
I haven't had any of that.
Have enough of that for a long time.
That's cool.
Yeah, it'd be nice for rain.
Yeah.
Clears the air up.
Oh yeah, it's good stuff. Let me see if I should. I don't know, I got one pen. Ah, I can use it.
We could use some rain.
Yeah, we could. All right. Oh, what? Greg called me like 3 times. I'm gonna go check and see what that's about. So I guess when you
take it off, don't take it off too early up there, because Krista was watching, so like all of you can see kind of you take it off and turn.
Go up to the seat. And then
yeah, right, that's perfect.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, no worries. Let me just keep this chin real quick.
Okay. Yeah, so we'll get going again.
Alrighty. Okay. Alright, so we're going to be back now, and I'm getting close to being able to do some of the fun stuff, which is bring it up to a finish. That's when I get into my calligraphy and all the subtleties of the drawing. Right now, it's fine. It's looking nice. It is what it is. It's just a blocking. It's a lay-in with some little bit of tone put on top of it, and that's a good place to be. So for some of you that are newer, you want to strive for like maybe this in a three-hour class, or not even this. I mean, like something way more rudimentary, light and dark. Don't get into too much halftone. Just take it easy. It takes years to get up to where you can build up a drawing and bring it to a finish. I mean, it takes a lot of years. So. And everything that I have this, unfortunate, well, I don't think it's unfortunate, but I'm just extremely honest with the amount of time it takes to do certain things based on how many years it's taken me, as well as other people I've seen come through the school, and just how long it takes. And some people do it faster than others, and some people bog down in other areas, and you're going to have your strengths and your weaknesses, so don't worry too much about any of that stuff. Hopefully, just fall in love with drawing. And if you do that, then it doesn't matter if it takes 5 years or 2 years or 3 years. You're going to find the time, and you're going to make the time, and you're going to get good, and you're going to become a professional at some point. And it might be, it'll probably take longer than you thought, and longer than you wanted it to. But in the big picture of things, a couple of years is nothing. It seems like a lot. People say, oh, a couple of years? I mean, it's going to take me 3 years to get good. It's like 3 years goes by like a blink of an eye. I mean, I don't know, it's unbelievable. So if you're doing the right thing, 3 years can make a year can make a world's of difference. You can improve hundreds of percent. If you're not doing the right stuff, you could have developed a lot of bad habits during that year, as well as stayed pretty much in the same holding pattern and did not much of anything happen, even though you drew every day. Because you weren't drawing the right stuff, you weren't studying the right things, and as a result, you were building up maybe bad habits that you didn't even know you were doing that later have to be removed by somebody that's very experienced. So, if you've got good training and access to it, whether it's through an online thing or through an actual school, it's incredibly beneficial to you getting to where you want to go in an efficient manner. I could have never gotten where I am now without the help of Glenn Orbeck and some of the teachers I had at the California Art Institute back in the day, and Fred Fixler for starting the school in the first place and passing it on to our generation. So I have a lot of people that I owe a great debt to for having shared that, taken their valuable time and shared it with me and other people. So I take it very seriously, the craft of teaching. It's not a craft, it's actually a career for some. For some, it's just something they do on the side and it's, casual, and that's okay too. But for the real ones that are really forging the next generation of good artists, it's a passion. It's a very serious pursuit. It's not something that we take lightly. So I'm laying in like a large tone, but I'm doing it kind of on the tip so that I get a little bit of noise, visual noise into it, so it's not so smooth, because I want it to have a little bit of character. Not something that if you're new, I would shade just clean. Don't worry about putting in this kind of cool looking noise and stuff that I talk about. That'll come soon enough. Just try to get a nice clean drawing that reads. It reads three-dimensionally on a flat surface. It has nice edges and values. Now, I know right now it was brought to my attention that the camera kind of is coming in and out of focus, because when I bent in, it focuses on my head. We'll put it on manual next time. This is the first time we've done one of these live streams, so we're just getting used to all the particulars of it. So it'll get cleaner and better each week. And we didn't even really announce this, so those of you who are watching just happened to stumble across it because we didn't really tell anyone. So I'm not quite sure how you found out about it, but I'm glad you're watching and enjoy. But in the future, we'll announce them, and you guys will know that it's coming up and that we're going to be doing a a demonstration or... And if it goes really well, we'll probably take it and do it occasionally from our studios. So we might take it into Lucas's studio and have him watch him working on a, you know, Wizards of the Coast or a Magic the Gathering card or something. And you might have Eric doing something. He's working on a lot of Predator stuff and all kinds of stuff right now for Dark Horse and different people. So, you know, you might watch me put in part of a fine art painting or... So we'll start doing more of that too. So there'll be a lot of fun stuff, just little perks for you guys that are involved and things that you can... you know, can keep you kind of engaged. Because I know sometimes when you're out there studying from abroad or studying far away and you're in another place, it's lonely, you know? And, you know, to have access to watching someone actually do their thing or getting to come into their studio and see them actually working is very rare. A lot of artists are very protective and secretive about how they work and stuff. And that's okay if that's what they want to be like. But I'm always trying to be more like an open book, let you guys kind of... you know, see what's going on, you know. So we'll be doing more of that stuff too. So now I'm going back in. I've got my drawing more or less filled in. And now I'm going to go into that head and I'm going to just finish it. Okay? So, what does that mean? Well, it's going to be about putting that last layer of value on. It's not going to be a lot because that head's already pretty close. So I'm just going to go in and try to give it that last little oomph, that last little... Okay. So I'm up on the tip a lot, and I'm drawing a little bit more like I write, which again, I tell you guys a lot of times that it's not good to do that. It's simply a rendering, more of a rendering type thing, and I don't, you know, I'll do it at certain times. Like right now I'm getting into small cross contouring, and what's cross contouring? It's drawing with and against the form to make it look really cool. Now that's part more of a linear concept. You can't really do that in oil paint very well, for example. There are some techniques that you can do it in, and that's like Prismacolor on top of acrylic or something like Drew Struzan might do, or, you know, Drew Struzan was a great movie poster illustrator during the 80s. He's still around and he's a phenomenal artist, and he had a technique that was really beautiful where it kind of was a hybrid between painting and drawing. And so there are techniques where you can utilize some of what I'm doing, but most like hardcore oil painting, you don't have lines to work with really. So it's more the domain of drawing, and that's one thing I do love about drawing, because I love cross contouring. I like inkers. I studied a lot of inkers. I've inked a lot. So that's where I get to exercise that aspect. And there's a certain sense of design that happens when you do that, that you can't learn any other way. So there's a lot of value in drawing in a linear manner. But I like to still have the overall feel of the piece to be very tonal. So a lot of times I have a sub-emphasis on cross-contouring layered into my tonal, which gives me a nice blend of the two. It's kind of like in painting where you want both silky, soft areas along with the brushy kind of claw marks that are left by the bristles. So you want to use both bristles and sables and use them in a creative manner to create a mosaic of variety in your piece that has a very nice aesthetic. I know it's a mouthful, but you know that's kind of what I'm looking for, is that nice sweet spot, that blend. And it's not always easy to find. I mean, it's challenging. I'm going to grab a different pencil, just one that's got a little bit better tip on it. That one took a little bit of its fire out of it as I was layering in the drawing. So down around where the bottom of the beard is, I can just kind of create little swirly strokes. I'm not going to sit and take inventory of every hair on the guy's beard. I mean, I'm going to make up the illusion of what I'm seeing. So I'm making up a version of his beard. Because to take inventory would be futile. It would, not only is it almost impossible to do, but it's hard to do and it doesn't look that great. So I'm not a big fan of hard and bad. That's not my top five favorites. So I'm gonna look for efficiency in my process, always. So here I am filling in my little head here, bringing it up. And you kind of just zen out, you know, just kind of sit. When you get into the rendering part of the drawing, it really is almost like active meditation. You're sitting and kind of just letting, you know, you're having the drawing
is starting to kind of take shape, and you're kind of looking at it, and sometimes you're trying to remove yourself from the process, but you're still staying really dynamic, really involved in it, obviously. So you see me doing these little like kind of chisel strokes in the shadow. It's just to add, again, take an area of shadow that's very boring, it's uniform, and create a little something happening there. Put a little, give it a little pizzazz, a little something to hang on to. So that's just more aesthetic. Again, that has nothing to do with what I see on the model. That's what I like to see on my drawing. So that comes under that header of what I'd like to see. And I've learned that from looking at other artists, copying them, picking up calligraphy off other people that I like, admire. So a lot of these shadows that were originally put in now need to be brought up to the full value range, which again is established up here in this head, which I'm still a little underneath. So I'm gonna go in and like right in here, put in my darkest dark in the eyebrow. And maybe the darkest dark in the hair is gonna be up here. So this is my blacks. These are my darkest darks that I can find. And those are going to allow me now to analyze every other value on the drawing off of the white of my paper and the dark of the darkest darks that I've established. Notice how I worked my way up to those darkest darks and I didn't just put them in really early in the drawing. Again, so this, yeah, it's a nice head. Okay, deltoid comes into pectoralis, so the deltoid rolls, it hits the pec, and then it rolls. Okay, so there's a nice rhythm that we use in the abstraction from upper pec, side to side. You always want to look, the abstraction works in this really interesting manner where a lot of times it tracks from one side to the other because the body is fairly symmetrical. Not totally, but fairly. So a lot of times what happens on one side can be carried over to the other side, and you can tie the two together by doing those sweeps from side to side. Just watch as I draw more throughout the weeks and months, and also on the videos that you're watching and the lessons, and we'll go over all that stuff. So you're going to get all this information over time. Don't worry about it. Okay, knock it down a little bit, step back, looks pretty good. So basically what I'm doing now is just bringing another layer to the drawing, and I'll just keep doing that until I run out of my time. At some point, you know, the time will run out and I'll have to go home and whatever, but or, you know, the class is over. But in between now and then, I'm just gonna do whatever I can to bring it up to the strongest finish that I can do. So now, okay, so I've worked the head, looks really good, down into the shoulder, started to get into some of the pec. Now I'm right going down into this arm, then I'll probably come back in down through this torso, back over this hand, then back into the legs. I'm working my way, skating my way down the forearm. Occasionally I might, venture back into the background and work on some folds, and then I'll go back into the body. So I'm pushing and pulling and bringing everything up together so I don't get too hyper-focused on any one area, which can be, you know, at this phase you could do that because it is the rendering phase of the drawing, but it still can be detrimental if you hyper-obsess about some area at the detriment to other areas that should be also paid attention to. So you want to just, you know, make sure that everybody's getting the fair attention and getting some love. You know, don't just hyper-focus. And here we've got some little muscles. Again, these are part of the ridge muscles as well as part of the extensors. And they're going to be hard on the bottom and softer on top. And so I just reaffirmed some of the bottom aspect by putting a darker, harder line under there. And that's a little too punchy for me right there. So I'm going to go over and knock it down with my finger. Then I'll glaze it back with a little bit, bringing the tone up next to it a little bit darker so it drops so it's not so punchy. And then it starts to lay down a little bit and starts to look more the way I would like it to look. And there's another, okay, so they're all emanating from around the epicondyle here, the lateral outside epicondyle of your humerus, the upper arm bone, coming down into the elbow. And then these muscles are all connecting between those points and going down into the individual fingers. So we're trying to find their origin up here and then make them look not too stringy and cheesy looking, but more, or you know, so I want to watch my, like, look at how uniformly thick that core is. That's a little disconcerting to me, so I might break it up somewhere. I might break it up from the side. There's any number of ways you could break it up, but the point is I caught the fact that it was too generic, and I made a decision to make an alter to alter it, to make it not look so generic. So again, coming down the torso into the oblique muscle. And I want this little bit of the torso here to pass in front of the oblique, pass in front of the thumb. So I have to make sure that those lines are very delicately handled. Otherwise, one's going to get in front of the other, and it's going to create a disturbance in the illusion of depth because the muscles aren't tracking properly. Now, your viewer may not know that, right? Because they don't know anatomy that well. They just know something looks kind of funny. So it's your job to know that stuff so that you can put your best foot forward when you're explaining the complexities of the body. Your critiquers, the people that look at your work, don't need to know. They just need to know whether they like it or not. They don't need to be able to tell you why they don't like it. So it's our job to know that. Okay, so on your, you can shake out that left hand if you, or right hand if you need to, Rob. Yeah, and then let it go back into that crease like that. Yeah, just there you go. That's perfect. So every once in a while, if you need to shake it out like that, feel free. No worries. Okay. So again, when you're working with your models, you know they're such an integral part of you doing a good job. And it's so hard to sit up there. So just lots of respect, lots of love for the model, because man, it's hard. And they do a great job, and when they're doing a great job, it helps you immensely. When they're not, then it really can be a hard, long day. So, you know, you always want to coach your models very intelligently and very caringly, because they're doing a wonderful job, and they make it possible to learn this stuff and everything. So, always be very respectful. Okay, coming down the form of the other side as well, we'll accentuate some of that. When I say accentuate, it's to bring forth, it's to make it more important, to make it seen. So when I accentuate something, I make it more, I exaggerate it, I embellish it. So just, you know, trying to find some of the folds that are in that little negative pocket between the torso and his hand. And so I'm going through and I'm kind of just, again, now this, the way this fabric is it's, again, it's like a drop cloth, which I love. It's probably one of my favorite drapery to drop. But it crinkles up and creates these really funny, cool bevels. And so you can kind of go in and just create abstractions of that. Sometimes just invent some. You don't really need to be that literal. Once you get the gist of what that drapery wants to do, then you can create cool versions of it on your own. That's a lot of times what I do, because I don't really have time, again, to take inventory of that drapery. It would take me a long time to map it in, and map it in ridiculously accurate. Maybe I need a 15-hour drawing to do that or something, maybe one of my longer efforts. But if it's in an indication-type drawing, a 3-hour drawing, that's pretty much a quick sketch, still. A 2 to 3 hour drawing is not, you know, in a lot of schools, especially the site-size ones, would be almost a joke. You know, they're used to spending, again, like hundreds of hours or 30, 40, 50 hours on a drawing or something. But I find that really the workhorse life drawing class for our school and our atelier is the 3-hour drawing, 2.5 hour to 3-hour drawing. And then, you know, our longest drawing that we normally do in classroom environment is 15 hours.
And I think you could spend a little, obviously, more than that. But some of the, sometimes we'll encourage people to take a photo, work from life most of the time, but then go home and do the drapery or lay in certain areas of the drawing from the actual photo because, you know, again, not being a purist, but being really disciplined artist, I want people to be pragmatic about training and try to do it in such a manner that's going to be realistic for maybe some of the trials and tribulations they're going to face as professionals. Now, if you're not planning on being a professional and you're doing this mostly for enrichment, then a lot of this stuff is a moot point and doesn't really need to be addressed that much, or even you can just casually listen to me bantering about it, but don't put too much weight on it because you don't need to. But yeah, if you're going to go out and say, hey, I've got to make my primary living, otherwise I'm going to starve as an artist, then I owe it to you to really prepare you for that in whatever way I can. And so you'll hear me, you know, kind of bantering a little bit about that periodically. And I'll try to keep it, you know, in a positive spin, but if possible. Okay. Okay, so just kind of getting that little piece of drapery right there, and then I'm going to darken it up a little bit, and then I'll pull it out with my eraser. So I'll go on my eraser and say, okay, there's a little fold right in there, and it's kind of dark on the inside, and then it has a little core shadow running along it. And I'll kind of, the little peat flap of the drapery comes around the corner there. And so I'm looking at, you know, picking out as well with my eraser as a way of cutting and carving my folds. Okay, I think I see some more questions just came in. I wasn't looking over there, so I'll look over there in a second. I'm going to stop drawing for a second. I'm going to read a few of them, see if I can address them. So one of them says, after you've mapped out the drawing, when the model is repositioned after the break and loses the original shadows of the earlier pose, do you remap, edit, or commit to what you have already drawn? I personally commit to what I've already drawn, and that's why I try to map really accurately when the model is in a session. And you can even map group to group, like you can work down to here and really spend your time mapping 120 minutes up in the torso and then have the legs be more general. And then the next pose, because you've mapped that so accurately, it doesn't matter if it moves a little bit. Then go down to the legs and really try to put the legs in, okay? So that's kind of, yeah, that's a really good question. And so sometimes I do a little redesign of the mapping. Sometimes the mapping looks better. Like he takes a, you know, the pose changes a little bit and it actually looks a little bit nicer. And if that's the case, I will take advantage of the nicer hand position or the nicer shadows on the hand or something and actually glue that on and fix it in the drawing. If I like my general map, so like for example, if I'm drawing and I see a really cool hand, I know that hand's not going to stay that way. There's no way. So I'll stop everything and go and put that hand in because that is, you know, that's you know, extremely important to get that in. And I'll try to map it as good as possible so that when it does change, I just refer to the model for maybe general tone, general value. That probably won't change that much, but the shapes were figured out when it was in the position that I wanted. So, you know, yeah, when you're drawing from life, you have to be very smart about how you navigate and how you solve these things and how you work your way around the forms. So hopefully that helped answer your question. That was a very good question. So the main thing to remember is it's a process that is very dynamic. The equations are changing all the time. The lighting's changing subtly all the time. He's breathing. His torso muscles are fluctuating in between active and inactive. And, you know, it's kind of like painting waves. In landscape painting, waves are one of the hardest because they're fleeting. There's no way to capture them. You can capture them from a camera and then try to paint them that way, which is fine. But if you're trying to paint it out in plain air, and plain air painting is really one area that requires such an incredible amount of retention and invention, in my opinion, to do it masterfully. Most of the great plein air guys I like are embellishing and inventing what they see. They're not copying what they see because there's no way to copy it because it's always changing. A cloud comes through and changes all your light patterns. It's always fleeting lighting conditions. So it's not very easy to paint what you see. You have to paint what you remember. You've got to map your shadows and then not chase them as the sun moves across the sky and changes your whole pattern of light in front of you. So yeah, plein air is one of those ones where you really have to start working on your retention and your ability. And it does cultivate that, just like life class does.
And that's where a photo won't as much, because you'll be a little bit, the photo's not moving, it's not doing what we're talking about. So that is one of the big differences. Okay. On another question, if you don't have access to live models, can pictures work too? Or are there some important skills you have to use a model to learn? That's kind of what I just went over. I was just kind of addressing that. I was talking about this idea that, yeah, photo work is not going to move on you, which is nice and really wonderful and all those good things. But it's not going to help you cultivate maybe quite as much of a sense of memorization. But you can do little exercises with photos that would help to cultivate that. You could basically take a photo and sit down and maybe do a 5-minute quick sketch from it or something, like a pose, and then put it away. And then from your invention, from your memory, you could then draw. Is that ours? Yeah. Okay, you can go ahead and shut up. We're going to take a little break, but I'll answer some of these questions while I'm breaking. That way I can, you know, kind of talk a little bit about this. The question about, you know, the model thing. So yeah, you can do little invention exercises. You can work in sketchbooks out of your memory. You can draw anatomy for a couple hours and then put it away to go take a break for 20 minutes, come back and see if you can draw something that you drew from memory without looking at that reference again. So all these are ways that you can cultivate a visual memory. You can start working on memorization skills that would then carry over into your life experience, life class experiences. But yeah, if you don't have access, I mean, to live models, I mean, there's always models around, unless you're in a country where they don't allow you to draw nudes or something, which I, you know, might be out there. But you can get some friends together or something and see if you can put together a little group of people and hire some models. Yeah, I mean, it's doable. That's how I kind of started when I first started my school when I was 22. It was just, you know, I didn't have a place to go, and there was nothing around. If there was a school, I would have gone to it, which would have been awesome, but there wasn't. When I moved back down to where I was originally from. So let's see. So on another question, if you don't have access, okay, got that one. Thanks for writing. Okay, cool. Well, I'm glad you guys are enjoying. It's my pleasure to sit and do this. I mean, I'd be drawing here anyway. So what I thought is for a lot of you that are starting to interact with us in a community online, I want to kind of bring some of the intimacy and the kind of learning environment that we normally have into the actual program. So you can look forward to more of this kind of these kind of comments and things, or these kind of exercises that we're going to be doing. So I'm going to take a little break. I'll be back in a few minutes, and I'm going to bring this up to a finish. It's looking really good. I'm going to go tune my pencils up. Always remember to do that, because that's what breaks are for. They're for you to stretch a little bit. Also, you know, if you're in a class, go look around and see what other people are doing. Okay. Thank you.
one's too hard in my brain.
I go to cafes in the morning, and some places play the most hideous stuff. It's like, what are they thinking of it? Like, in the morning, you want to do techno.
Yeah, I know, I know.
It's so crazy.
I know. Like, these are kind of cool, because I grew up, you know, this is stuff that we, I was in high school or something, you know, this music, right? Yeah. But usually we'll put on, like, I like to switch between classical or...
Or classical.
Yeah, I mean, especially for creative stuff. It's,
it's so true. It's so much easier to play.
Yeah, I know. I find my taste changing quite a bit as I get older. But I like all kinds of stuff. It really depends on what mood I'm in. But drawing, I can pretty much paint anything. But I prefer kind of mellow stuff now.
Yeah, I think if it's too
jarring,
synthesized, or too sonically aggressive, I think it turns your whole body's.
Well, the creative process, too. I mean, some people I can study and listen to music, memorize stuff. I can't. I gotta have, like, totally quiet. Like, when I was in high school or college, you know, when I was studying math or English or
history. That even reading it, so I can't do it. I can even read for a person that I have no multitasking abilities.
No, none.
I am a non-multitasker. I'm a unitasker.
All right.
So,
what are we at here?
Do I have to undress up here? Is that the deal?
I would, just because the camera kind of suits right past it.
I just wanted to make sure.
Yeah, no worries. No worries. That's totally cool. Let's see.
You know, go in the Triple X art realm.
Okay. All right. So, I'm getting ready to get back into it, everybody. And it's going really well. I'm pretty happy with everything. Those little things that will always kind of bug me a little bit, and I'll just be kind of working on those as we go, and some of them will resolve themselves, some may not. Drawing is a dynamic process, and it's one that, as we do it more and more, we become a little bit more comfortable with this idea of being uncomfortable. Because, you know, there are going to be times in drawings where they're just not going in your favor, and if you freak out and get really uptight, it's like a train wreck, you know? I mean, you just have to really keep your wits about you. And most of that just means being, again, staying present, stay relaxed, take deep breaths, stretch a little bit, loosen up. Try to remember that this is just a drawing. This is not playing in the Olympics. This is preparing you. If you are preparing yourself for professional challenges of professional life as an artist, then these are the little daily exercises that are getting you prepared for the pressures of doing that. And if we keep that in mind, then it's not so scary and not so overwhelming. It's just a drawing. It's a little new drawing, you know. It's anatomical exercise. It's just moving shapes around. You don't know what a shape is, and you can't name it, and you can't tell what it is, and where it goes, and what it does, don't worry about it. Draw the shape best you can. Later, make a mental note. Got to go look at that area and check it out on one of your, Visible Body app or Elliot Goldfinger's Book on Anatomy or something, and go back and after you're done with it, and do a little detective work on your drawing. Put a piece of tracing paper over it. Go into it and fix it on your own with the help of my drawings, with the help of other drawings that you like, with the help of anatomy books, and be like a detective. Really get in there and figure out what went wrong. Oh, I didn't draw that leg well. Why? Because I don't draw legs that often, and I stay away from them because I'm really kind of scared of them. Well, get in there and learn how they're constructed and how they work, you know? For some of you, this will be a real eye-opening experience, this program, because it's an honest way of training. And a lot of times, people think they're training honestly, but they really aren't, because no one's really telling them, and they think they're going through the paces, and they're doing the right thing, but they're really way off base. Later, when they finally see someone actually drawing really, really, really well, or painting really, really well in front of them, it's almost like they're watching a magic trick. It's like, how did you learn to do that? I mean, it seems so unattainable, so far away from where you are. And in all honesty, it may be pretty far away from where you're at. So, but it's not unattainable with the proper knowledge, proper sequence, and proper training regimen. What you got to do is find out what that is, and then then put it into practice. And that's where most people falter, because it's consistency that gets you where you need to go. Not passion's one thing, but can you burn that passion for decades? Or is it the kind of passion that only lasts a very short period of time and then fizzles out and then it's on to something else? There's a book called Mastery by George Leonard. And it's a little book, and it's a really wonderful book that you really should pick up and do a little reading of. And it talks about the art of mastering anything, whether it's a martial art or a sport, athletic endeavor, or it's an academic endeavor, or it's a artistic endeavor, musical, whatever. And it's very poignant and insightful, and it really, you know, it goes back to, again, loving the repetition of the process and learning to love that aspect of it, which then guarantees ultimate success in the long run. But because it is going to be a long run and there is no way around that, if you have a fleeting personality that likes the thrill of the chase and then is quickly bored and then wants to go to another thrill of the chase and then is quickly bored and then wants to go to another you basically just meander around your life not perfecting things, not mastering things. And for some people, maybe that's just fine. But if you're trying to be a professional that makes their primary living doing something, that's not fine and that will not work. So ultimately, you would have to readjust your personality, the way that you think, the way you operate, to be conducive to mastery. And so, you know, he labels a number of people in that book, you know, whether you're the dilettante or the dabbler or he has these labels for the different kinds of personality types and where they fit in that kind of big picture of mastering stuff. And so that little book could be a very, very good read for you if you're finding you've kind of hit this wall and you're kind of finding that you have this tendency to get really excited about something, but then when the going gets really tough, you kind of have a tendency to fizzle out a bit. And then what happens is the mind starts to look for excuses and create, and it can be really very powerful and good at creating, you know, very believable excuses for keeping you from doing something like learning to draw or paint, because it's hard. And if you associate pain with that process, the mind will find a way to keep you from doing it. So you want to make sure that you're not entertaining those thoughts with, this is too difficult, this is impossible, I'll never learn this, I can't believe how hard this is, oh my God, it's terrible, it's difficult. If you keep reaffirming that, you're basically going to find a way to make that a reality, right? And you can be incredibly, your mind will be incredibly creative with how it does that to let you off the hook. So you've got to be responsible, you've got to take responsibility, you got to get in there and fight the good fight. And really don't let up on it. And I've had people come on with fictitious joint problems. I've been there myself. I've had people claim carpal tunnel or whatever. And really, I think it was just the mind trying to get them to stop doing it because they were associating so much pain with it. Yes, it's going to be hard, but that doesn't mean it needs to be painful. It's just hard. There's a lot of hard things that are worth doing that are really quite fun in the long run once you get past that initial fear factor or, oh my God, this is so difficult. I don't know if I'm going to be able to do this. I don't think any of us haven't gone through that period where we thought we might not be able to make this happen, or, oh my God, I think I should look for a different job, or, oh geez, I don't know if this is going to be able to become a reality. But we pushed through it somehow. And a lot of times it was with the help of a really good instructor, a really good coach, a really good person that's already been there, that sat you down and said, listen, you know, I've been through that. I've watched thousands of people go through that. Here's what you got to do, you know. Or sometimes it's tough love. Sometimes it's someone leveraging you a little bit and getting on you and having to kind of ride you a little bit to get you to get out of that funk that you're in. Okay, so we're down around the feet, the drapery. We're getting it covered. I've got about a half an hour, 40 minutes left, so I don't know, a couple of sessions, maybe another two sessions. Okay. So over in the drapery, I'll just do a little bit of this. We're just going to look for darks, and then we're going to map them. We're going to look for who's in front of who.
And again, the drapery will alter. So if you get into doing drapery, you might want to do it in one 20-minute session and really get it all mapped in and try to get it as close to as done as possible during that 20. And then if you want to put a little finishing touches in, you've already got it so well laid in that you don't really need it. Even you could almost do it from invention at that point. Okay. So again, the drapery is it kind of intertwines and overlaps around itself. I've got some previously mapped areas that are now different, but I like some of them, so I'm going to kind of see if I can keep a few of them. And again, I don't need to make this into Bouguereau drapery or something, you know, where it's just ridiculously... I want it to be second to the figure anyway. But I do want it to look like a nice graphic shape and have some believability to it so that it doesn't look like it was totally phoned in. Look for the tension points. Look for where the folds are emanating from. And that's another reason why you learn to draw the nude figure before you learn how to drape it, because you need to know where the tension points are to be able to drape it efficiently. If you don't know those tension points, it's very difficult to drape a believable figure, especially an invented one, if you're making it up. Okay, so I'm just kind of, again, looking up at the model, and then I'm coming down and I'm pulling out that information. So you're really always working from invention, because you look at the model, you see it, and then you look down and it's gone. So when you're drawing after you look at the model, you can't look at the model and draw at the same time, so you're always drawing from memory, really. So when people say memory work, that's really terrifying. Well, you're always doing it, you're just not maybe aware that you're doing it. I'm able to look at the model, retain quite a bit, and come down and work for a longer length of time than maybe you're going to be able to. So I'm here kind of doing, you might have to look up two or three times while I'm doing it once, because my retention's a little bit greater because of my how much further along I am in my training. But don't worry about that. Just pointing out a maybe an observation of something that might have gone unnoticed. Okay, so I'm kind of looking, everything's going good. I can't tell whether, I can't see any new questions coming in, but I think it's because we're at the bottom of where the question area is on the YouTube channel thing there, so maybe it's that. But again, you know, keep firing them at me if you got them. Otherwise, just enjoy, sit back, relax, get a cup of coffee, have some popcorn, I don't know. Just, hopefully it's entertaining. Yes. Yeah, it's good stuff. But you guys are going to make it, and you're going to do just fine. I've watched thousands of people get good at this stuff, or hundreds at least, but I mean, I've had thousands and thousands come through. And really, the ones that have succeeded ultimately are the ones that just love it the most. The ones that really develop a sincere appreciation and love of the craft. Those are the ones that you really see at the finishing line. Not the ones that were looking for a quick buck or, you know, how fast can I get good? And can I cut corners? And do I really have to do that? And oh my God, you know. Those are the people, you know, they're already looking for excuses. They're already looking for the easy way out. You know, that's not going to get you there. You know, what's going to get you there is sweat equity. You know, just hard work. Just all good old-fashioned hard work. I mean, everyone would like to think that maybe they're, you know, like, there's some reason why this person made it and they didn't, and it's because they have better genetics or they're, you know, more wired. It's like, no, maybe they just worked harder. Maybe they just studied more diligently. There's such a thing as just that, you know? And so I know a lot of people don't want to admit that sometimes, like, oh, well, they're kind of procrastinators or they don't like to, you know, follow through or whatever. But ultimately it does come down to a lot of times just simple, the person just didn't do the work, didn't take anatomy enough. Skipped out a quick sketch because it was too hard. Didn't really like, you know, whatever. You know, it could be a thousand different reasons. But the ones that make it, man, they just stick it out. They just grind it. They're grinders, you know. And they take slow, some of them are really slow. Like I've watched people that are so, they learn so slowly, but they have such long-term grinding ability. Like they're just their general personality type is a real grinder. And those people really can go really far. You know, way farther than the natural talented ones that are kind of lazy, you know. So don't never what I'm saying is never count yourself out because you think you don't have the genetics for it, or you just don't have that gift. The gift, whatever gift you have, will only reveal itself after a huge amount of hard effort. And if the gift is not strong in the first place, then there's that old saying that some people would say that technical training stifles creativity or your initial spark or whatever. And there's another saying that any spark that's that fragile isn't worth developing in the first place. And that's where I come from. It's like, dude, if you can't handle a little bit of hardcore academia in your training, then whatever that little spark is in there is so weak, it won't even really matter. You know, it doesn't have any legs to stand on in the first place. So, yeah, academic training is not going to make you lose your creativity. It's only going to open it up to greater area range, especially if you want to, you know, again, if you want to do something really abstract or something, that's a whole different thing. That's not what we're talking about. But if you want to paint like Bouguereau, you want to paint like Sargent, you want to aspire to Fechin's level, you want to work like some of these great masters of the past, it's all about fundamentals, it's all about repetition, it's all about correct execution, it's all about longevity and long-term training. And that's what those people did for their whole lives. And then they ultimately made a living at it. But way before they ever made a living at it, they were grinding, you know, grinding it, finding creative ways to find the time, you know. And you guys can do it. I know you can. You know, I've watched it time and time again. And I had to do it myself. So, you know, I relive it with all you guys, you know, the people I train on a daily, weekly basis, yearly basis. So I'm extremely familiar with that feeling. But anyway, so this drawing, yeah, it's got a cool shape. I like this nice sweep that's coming through, hanging this nice figure on it. It's got a nice kind of, you know, composition like this. And it's, it's got a good feel. This little negative pocket in the arm here, I knocked it down with some tone because it's actually popping out too much. So I wanted to play it down a little bit. And so I put a little tone in there to get it to not be so obnoxious. So now at this stage in the game, we're pretty far in. It's down to little greebles and little areas and getting in and putting little halftones and highlights and rendering out vein networks and tendons and getting into the feet and doing some work on the toes and on the knuckles and trying not to make anything too weak. So like this hand is a little weak on my drawing. And it's not bad. It's a nice silhouette. It's changed periodically, and again, it's going to be more of an invention job than it would be anything else, because you know, I'd have to take out quite a bit of it to match what's up there. So I'm just going to play around with it a little bit. It would help if I had the right amount of fingers there, which is funny. Sometimes you'll see me count toes and fingers because they're easy. I'm going to take this and rework it a little bit. So. Okay, that's going to happen. So let me see what I can do here. The index finger is a little separated from... Yeah, okay. That's okay. You shake it out and then put it back. I'm drawing that one. So just shake it out and then put it back where you know. But that's okay. If you need a break, that's great. So now this finger comes in here. And then we got another one. Slip in here. And then we've got the pinky kind of shooting up. Now the knuckle here is maybe bowed a little bit because it's kind of pushed up against the inside of the leg where the other ones are kind of wrapping around it. So I'm going to see if I can try to get that effect a little bit. So I need to erase like that leg shape there a little bit. I'm gonna be a little quiet for a second. I've been talking a lot, so just sit and draw for a little bit and just relax and enjoy. So again, this index finger is not working for me. So I'm gonna revisit, you know, play around with it a little bit here. I need a little bit more room in there for those fingers. They feel a little too cramped. So what I'm gonna do is come down, take a look. So I'm gonna pull up this index finger a little bit higher. Here we go. Because I felt like, you know, I felt like I was trying to cram on an extra finger and I just didn't have the room for it. After you've taken out a hand a couple times, and it will happen more than you would like to, you know, would like it to, you've got to be careful as you get further in, because those committed lines that were there before are going to start shining through, and it starts getting really hard to see the forest for the trees, you know? It gets really hard to know what's going on. So I'll slow down, I'll take more care, and I'll start to really put my A game on, you know, which not like I haven't been already, but man, I'll really start to have to slow down and say, okay, wait a minute here, we don't have too many more shots at this. Let's slow down and let's see if we can really figure out how to make this a decent hand. Now, some hands are never going to be magical hands, sergeant hands, fetching hands, unless you invent them. Sometimes they're just going to be, like my dad would say, a clump of bananas, you know, and when they're like that, you're just going to get an accurate hand, you're not going to get an inspirational hand. And in a hand is as hard or harder than the head, probably. And it's just, they're expressive, they're gangly and difficult, and so they require a lot of TLC. So the knuckle here, and then we've got, obviously, there. We have tendons coming off of them. Just trying to keep it kind of simple, not open up the Pandora's box here with it. Just try to keep it, who's in front of who? So this dark line pops this one in front of this one pops this one in front of this one. And we got it going with a little bit of soft rendering along the actual finger itself to create a little. Yeah, that's way better. Whew. Yeah, so I mean, again, it's just one of those things. Now I'm going to glaze a little tone over it to knock down some of those knuckle lines as well as some of those tendons. And then I'll just go in too, and I'll just keep just really gingerly working my way around that hand, trying to save face here. And it's, you know, again, it's not going to win any huge awards, but it's not going to make it look like, oh man, really, yeah, a beautiful head, beautiful arm, beautiful torso, oh my gosh, you know, crazy hand there. That, you know, you don't want that to happen in, so you want to make sure. So we're going to have one more short session after this, and that'll be my finishing session where I'll go in and I'll start to, you know, it's kind of like you're at the, you know, the 2-minute warning or something at the end of the football game, and you've just got like a couple downs left and you got to really make them count. And that's when you start really looking for, okay, what do I want to bring to this drawing at the very end here that could just, you know, give it a little extra something. And, we call it, you know, I always say, you know, okay, it's magic strokes. This is time to put in the real, you know, pull out the
stops and really go at it. And really, sometimes you'll chatter a drawing, you know, you'll ruin a drawing in those last time when you're really trying to get in there and make something special happen. But you got to be willing to risk drawings. They're just drawings. They're not precious, and nor should they be thought of as. They're just exercises in trying to become proficient. So don't put that pressure, oh my God, this is my best drawing, and I'm never going to do another good one in my life, and oh my God, you know, just relax. You do better ones. And just try, you know, sometimes just try stuff. And especially if you're in an environment with good instructors. If you're not, then, you know, you can be a little bit more tentative, but still, try stuff. What's the worst that can happen? I've scrubbed thousands of paintings, hundreds of paintings, and I'll probably scrub 100 more before it's over. So, and drawings, I've, you know, done the same. So, it's just happens. But you always put your best effort forth. Always try to do a good job. And pat yourself on the back for the good areas you did do. Having a whole drawing work as a whole is really a daunting task. But you'll have a good hand, you'll have a good leg, you'll have part of, you know, maybe parts of the head will be really nice. Maybe it didn't all come together for you, but most of it's working pretty good. Those are huge little successes. You know, don't undervalue those. Don't be so hard on yourself. And, you know, and you're going to see people doing good stuff, and you're going to think, oh, really, you know, that drawing's so much better than mine. And maybe the person's been drawing for 5 more years than you, and it's got a lot more mileage. You got to factor that in. It's not really a competition amongst other people. That's what's cool about art. I mean, it's competitive out there, and there's no way around that. But as far as, in, you know, as an art in general, it's just it's a nice process where it's not quite as cutthroat as some, you know, other sports and things, you know. So it's kind of nice. Lots of room for different styles, lots of room for different opinions, lots of room for variety and variation. Should encourage that, not stifle that. Yeah, so again, down in this drapery, I really literally can just create little abstractions of shape that look like something's going on. Thanks, Jerome. Take a break. We have one little short session left, and you're going to be good to go. Okay, so I'm going to take a little break right now. Again, see that most of you are still watching, which is really cool. We're going to finish it off here in about 10, 15 minutes. So, you know, not good as fireworks aren't going to be going off or something, but it'll be a nice little drawing. Thanks again for taking the time to join me. Model break. Be back in a few minutes. It's weird because it's like I look over there and I'm still drawing because it's
really?
2 minutes behind.
Yeah, it's delayed.
So I'm looking at my mirror.
How does it do that?
Yeah, I don't know.
That's crazy.
Like, how do you
So yeah, just this area, you know, could be modeled a little bit more. But as far as I can read, your light and dark, where you're choosing for your light and darks, really good. Those are all huge things. What we're starting to talk about here is rendering, you know, subtle rendering things, which are hard. That's what really comes down to the last one. That's the most hard to do things. I mean, it's harder to do what they're telling you than what they're talking about.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's an awesome batsman. All right, let's do it. So let's finish this one off.
Cool.
I don't really need to set the timer, do I?
We got 10 minutes. Let's just do 10. You might want it because that way you'll be out there. Otherwise, I might get caught in drawing and you're like still be sitting there. You know, I don't want you to.
Yeah,
have
let
to.
The timer do the work.
Yeah, exactly.
We're too late. Yeah.
Okay, so we're getting back into this. It's gonna be the last 10 minutes. We got 10 minutes left, everybody. So. You guys did a great job sticking with me through this, and like I said, we'll be doing this probably every other week, and I'll have some of the other guys coming in and working on stuff, so you got a lot to look forward to. This will just be a little almost bonus for you guys, and I'll be doing podcasts as well, so I'll be, you know, doing podcasts on training and inspirational subjects, professionalism. Just my favorite artists. I might be talking about books that are inspirational to me. I'll also be going over, I'd like to do one. I think one of the first ones I'll do is on training regimens and how to set up a proper training regimen for yourself. So we'll be doing all that kind of stuff also. So it'll be good stuff. Okay, Avenue looks cool. We're looking good. Yeah. So now at this stage in the game, it's all about the little finishes. It's about going in and maybe looking at the hands, looking at the feet, looking at the toes, looking one last time at the head, and is there anything that we missed that maybe slipped through the cracks? Because it's easy to have things get kind of they slip through those cracks, you know, because you're too busy focusing on something else, or your hand smushed over something that got kind of used to be kind of nice, and now it's kind of gotten too blurred out or something, needs to be brought back up. So all these are things that you think about towards the end of a drawing. You start, and then once you're done, you're done. You know, I just put it aside. I usually save my drawings once a term. I kind of go through my pad and I gut my pad, take out all my best work, label it as to what semester it was. I don't do that anymore because I'm on like semester 98 or something. So, but I used to, and I would then put them, in a place where I could go back and refer to them. So I could see what kind of growth patterns were happening. Every once in a while, you'll forget how much better you are because you're too busy concerned about what you're not good at right now. And you need to look at where you came from. Like, where were you a year from that or back? And you need to go, in order to do that, you need to save those drawings. So save your best efforts after each term or if you're in a school somewhere. And put them under the bed or, you know, clip them onto a piece of cardboard from the back of your drawing pad or something. And just put them away. And once a year, drag out all your old drawings and from last year, set them all out, your best efforts, and see what kind of growth has occurred. You'll be amazed. A lot of people just they're so busy being frustrated with not being better where they're at that they don't really think about where they came from. We got to constantly really reward ourselves for those little victories, those daily victories, the little subtle ones, because those are the ones that stack up to be huge ones. And those are the ones that keep you motivated to keep going. If you're only berating yourself constantly, and that's why I'm not a very hard teacher on people because they're hard enough on themselves. I mean, you don't need to go browbeat them, you know? I mean, they're already killing themselves minute by minute every day as they're studying. So you just need to be compassionate with them and give them a, you know, you need to be critical with them and say, hey, you know, this ain't working, this is why it's not working, this is where you might want to go to study something to get better at this. But you don't need to be like, oh, this is the worst thing I've ever seen, and oh my God, you know, this is terrible, and all this stuff. You know, I mean, I've seen some teachers who are just crazy, and they're so mean, and they don't need to be. Let's see. Okay, so I'm very respectable tonight, and very thankful. I was a little worried because I was coming in a little cold after breaking my arm. I didn't draw much for the last couple weeks, and I was a little worried that I was going to come in and be really cold. But it may be good for you to know that I still feel that way. I still feel nervous about efforts. And I respect the craft so much that I never am complacent about it. and think, oh yeah, I'm just going to do a good drawing because I'm that good. It's like, no, the minute I don't pay attention, I'll do a really bad drawing, and it'll be really embarrassing, even more embarrassing, because it's inexcusable when you get to my level. To not inexcusable, but you shouldn't be doing rookie errors, daydreaming, whatever. You should be past that. And so you want to work to really become, you know, a strong finisher, a strong executor, and have a really good pace. Just like a runner that paces themselves out of the chute. You know, they're, you don't just go sprinting out of the freaking gate and then expect to carry that on for 26 miles. You know, you got to kind of know yourself really well, and you got to pace yourself as you go. Otherwise, you're going to burn yourself out early or flame out early. You know, you got to be really smart. And that only comes through experience. There's no other way to get it. And usually experience comes from messing up or you know, having something bad happen or you know, you don't get experience by good things happening. Usually you learn a lot more from those failures and those difficulties. So embrace them. You don't have to like them, but don't, you know, embrace them. They're good. They're teaching you tons. So I build it up, break it down, build it up, break it down, build it up, break it down. That's my kind of mode of operation. And that's how I work in painting. You build the painting up, you scrape it down, you soften it out, over soften it too much, got to go back, build it back up again. So doing a painting is like doing 10 paintings. It's not doing one. It's a tear down build up process. And somewhere in there, each time you tear down, each time you build up, something magical happens. Some little happy accidents, some little things that you couldn't have probably premeditated and done deliberately. Happen, and that's the magic. That's the fun too. It's where, yeah. I don't want a cold and calculated method of working that, yes, it yields good results, but it's like completely soulless and really stale, and it's like pulling teeth, you know. And I've seen styles like that and techniques where it's like, just doesn't look like the person doing it's having a lot of fun, you know. It looks like it's really brutally difficult and not, you know. Are there people that maybe revel in that kind of, you know, methodology or something? I'm sure there are. But, you know, not me. I'm not one of them. I like a hard challenge, that's for sure. And I don't shy away from it, and that's for sure. But I do want it to be fun. And so if you find yourself working, and you got to really differentiate between that. What's fun and what's hard work? Because it's all going to be hard work, and hard work is usually not that fun. But we have to differentiate between that, and then when we're doing in a pattern that really is not us, and we're not operating within our authenticity, right? That can be problematic in the long run, because you might find yourself becoming successful in a style that you just can't stand doing. And then your job becomes this kind of self-made prison that you've created for yourself. So we don't want that to happen. But don't worry, those are things that we won't even get to for a long time. Right now, it's about doing a good figure drawing. It's about doing a nice head lay-in. It's about learning the Asaro head and the abstractions and learning the skulls and all these particulars before we ever get to the wonderful, you know, personal identity of our way that we're working. That's a lifetime endeavor. I'm still waiting to find my voice. I mean, I'm pretty strong and pretty far down the road, but I still feel like there's a lot for me to explore, and that I'm nowhere near where I really want to be. But I'll continue working, and I'll continue exploring, and I'll continue to unravel the mystery of who I'm ultimately going to be as a painter. But that's really a lifetime. That's a lifetime of work. That's what's fun about it. Yeah, that's why I picked it and didn't pick some other career that was easy, you know. Okay, coming along, going back in, because my hand has moved over a lot of the drapery and put a veil of tone over it that I want to pull back out, some of the little, maybe some of the little folds, and get a few of them to pop, 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 and then play a few down and pop a few here and play a few down. So it's that push and pull around. I don't want the eye to jump around the drawing like a ping pong table, but I do want it to flow nicely. And so, you know, every area now is being looked at as to how it accentuates or how it tells the story of this figure with the scene, with this drapery, in this position. And is it working to my satisfaction? And pretty soon, I've got a few minutes left only, probably, so I don't have a lot of time left to make any rash decisions or any major changes. So luckily, I don't think that's necessary at this point in this drawing, but if it was, I would just have to make a mental note for the next one and try to work my approach a little bit better and see what happens. So I'm kneading my eraser into little chisel, sharp bevels so that I can pull out some of the nice, yeah, you can shake that out. I'm working on your head. So if you want to even move that, if you want to move that hand somewhere else, you can do it. I'm not working on it. So yeah, just shake it out. Don't worry about it. Or leave it to the side, or it's all good. Okay, so coming down the mustache. Doing a great job, Yoram. Really, really great. Yeah. Okay, you're good to go. So that's it for this first night of streaming, and I really appreciate those of you who tuned in, because I know I didn't, like I said, I don't even know how you found out, but you probably just stumbled over it. But we'll be doing it more often, and I'm really, 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 really thankful that, and helpful. I'm just really, it's really my pleasure to do it. So anyway, we'll probably see you again, you know, and I'll notify you, and we'll put up some posts to let you know when they're coming up. But I plan on doing this pretty regularly, so we'll see you very soon. Thanks a bunch, and I'll see you when I see you. Cool. Yeah, it came out nice. Good job. Thanks. Yeah, that was fun.
Is that your equipment?
Yeah, I'm always trying, yeah.
Yeah, that's what we're best
with. Well, we've got the equipment that we actually shoot the videos with is way, way more in-depth, but well, yeah, it just slowly, you slowly kind of invest back into it, and you know, the beginning we were using other people's equipment that wasn't that good, and the quality wasn't as good as we wanted.
What a bummer about borrowing people's stuff. Can't they have top-of-the-line stuff?
Well, even then, I was paying good for stuff that wasn't very good, you know, running it. But then, yeah, it's just, you know, you couldn't afford your own stuff, so you kind of have to just kind of work your way into it. That's all good.
His knee looks so amazing.
That's cool. Thanks. Thank you. Let's see. I'll probably... Cool.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, no worries.
Yeah, you know, you got to translate that drawing complex into not hurting your body.
I know. I know. And I love to challenge myself by doing things that, you know, usually are kind of...
Oh, man, I used to play tennis. Ultimately, it got to be where my knee was going to get so chewed up, I couldn't work. So I said, okay, got to end that recreational habit.
Yeah, that's, you know, and it's funny.